Yes, really. Okay, well, not really, really, but pretty much. Kingdom Hearts 358 days over 2. Yes, that's how you say it. It's that many days shared by two people. You do not need to simplify to 179. And thank God for that, because I hate math more than Saix hates Shion. Some might call it a ripoff, some might call it mercy, but you do not actually play all 358 days of Roxas's time in the organization. If you're entrenched in the Kingdom Hearts fandom, you probably knew that, but I'm just offering a refresher. But several days of Roxas's life and employment are lost to comas and or time jumps, and I can't very well rank days that are functionally invisible. Some days have invisibles, and I will rank those. So I'm ranking every day that we can see. You'll notice I didn't say every day that we can play, because some days are seen but not played. Occasions that are cutscene only that involve no missions or player agency beyond pressing A to read dialogue. Those will be included. Optional missions, and by extension, optional days, whether they're available through no extra effort or unlocked by completing tasks for your coworkers, will be included. For better or worse, every time that top screen shows the day counter change, I'll be talking about what happens until that counter changes again, every single time. And between you and me, just us two, the ranking exercise is just a convenient vehicle to talk about a game that I've never given more than a few minutes of attention to on this channel. Don't get me wrong, I put thought into the order things went in, as I've done for similar exercises across the channel, but I won't die on a hill for any given day belonging higher or lower than any other day. Ranking is ultimately, to quote the great Survivor alum Stephen Fishback, an arbitrary and reductive exercise, an exercise I take great glee in nonetheless. I'd be remiss and fiscally irresponsible to not point out that this video was made possible by my patrons at patreon.com/regularpat. This video is something I had promised to make for quite a while in exchange for reaching the 150 patron milestone, and I am eternally grateful to have been shown such generous support. If you enjoy, I humbly direct you to the aforementioned URL if you'd like to chip in to help me make more content about these key games full-time. A bit of background information and general thoughts before we get started, timestamp for the understandably impatient here, navigate there at your own risk of misunderstanding me, Dazed is not a game I am intimately familiar with in the way that I am with any of the numbered titles. Well, I guess Dazed is actually very numbered, some might say it's even too numbered. What I mean is, Dazed is not something that I know like the mainline games and even some of its fellow side games. I've done a full playthrough of it 3 times. The first time was at release in 2009 when my dad randomly brought it home for me because my dad kicks fucking ass. I guess I'm just gonna hype up my dad during my intros now. The second time was on my Twitch channel in 2022, and the third time was over the past few weeks while getting footage for this video. So while I've experienced it in full a few times, I'm nowhere near an authority on it. Frankly, I'm not an authority on anything, I just have a microphone, and you'd all do well to remember that. With regards to my general feelings on Dazed, they've definitely fluctuated over the years. I think as a kid, I was just enamored with having a game about the organization, and on top of that, one I could retreat to on the bus after a tough day of middle school. I bet you could tell by my having a Kingdom Hearts YouTube channel that I had some tough days of middle school. I feel like I carried a bit of disappointment upon realizing fairly early that you couldn't exactly play this game in the same manner that you might play a KH1 or 2, but again, a game where you can play as Axel or Demix, I was able to let that gripe go. As time went on and other entries released, Dazed definitely dropped in my personal rankings, perhaps unfairly beneath some games, but pretty comfortably beneath others. But as I've revisited this game twice now in the 2020s, I've grown a newfound or refound appreciation for it. It's still not the first game in the series I'd grab to play in my free time, or the second, third, fourth, or fifth, but it's not this excruciating gameplay experience that some might make it out to be. There are excruciating moments, or worse, excruciating days, and we'll talk about those, but I didn't let those occasions define my experience. I found myself quite enjoying my time with Dazed on my most recent playthrough, and just appreciating the game for what it is. For many, it was an entry point, albeit an unorthodox one, into the series. The DS was super accessible and popular, being only second to the PS2 in terms of total units sold for a video game system. So like, how mad am I gonna get at a game from 2009 on the DS that introduced a ton of people to a series I hold dear? Well, very mad, but again, only at certain moments. As a whole, Dazed ain't bothering nobody. Dream Drop Distance drowned my son in a community swimming pool, and I'm kidding, but only because I've never had a son. If I did, I know it would. Is the Dazed gameplay super smooth and quick and precise? No, but it's also not the slogfest that many of us may remember it as, or at least it doesn't have to be. A degree of experimentation with the game's mechanics, whether that be its panel system, its surprisingly varied magic options, or clever use of items, can pave the way for more efficient solutions to some of the game's most notorious obstacles. Usually. And granted, sometimes this experimentation can feel rewarding, and sometimes it can feel like trial and error. Some players, myself included at times, can be stuck in their ways or attached to a certain build or playstyle, and Dazed will not reward such loyalty. No game in the series asks you to break a habit like Dazed does, and that's ultimately going to appeal a lot to some people or push people away, and I found myself somewhere in the middle on that. Of course, the gameplay is just one side of things. As for the other side and the other story, the story. From my viewpoint, DAZED has pretty consistently been perceived as a game that overall thrives more on the story side than the gameplay side, and I think that perspective was only bolstered by the game being effectively ungamed for its inclusion on the HD remix. While I ultimately still agree that the story is the game's stronger side, I don't think the 1.5 movie is really the definitive way to experience that story, even if it's shinier and fully voiced. I'm not the first person to express this, but you're losing something when you reduce what could potentially be a 30-hour playthrough to a 3-hour cutscene marathon. I'm thankful it exists as a convenient and more accessible way to get new players up to speed or give returning players an abridged refresher on the game's happenings, but it does a bit of a disservice to what I do think is some of the best character work in the series. Ironically, the game centered on so-called nobodies contained, by my estimation, some of the most relatable character moments, at least by Kingdom Hearts standards. Probably because most of us know what it's like to clock in and clock out and shoot the shit with friends. And while you do get to see a lot of those moments in the movie, you don't get to feel the raw time of it all, the occasionally grueling missions that break up those interactions. You also just miss out on some nuance or flat-out funny moments that didn't make the leap from DS to PS3. I say all of this not blind to the fact that the story does have its detractors, whether that's due to the sheer nature of Xion's invention and the level of focus on her, or a sense of repetitiveness that the story can impart. We'll get to more on that later, but I found that the game really is best enjoyed in small chunks, as was probably intended, for rough day-having middle schoolers who can squeeze in some day's time and take down a mission or two on the bus or after homework but before bed. Binging the game will probably wear on you a bit, especially if you're already struggling with the gameplay side of things. Even still, the story and these character interactions might not be for everyone, and that's alright, though I do think chalking up all or most of these conversations to "ha ha ha, we are friends," while fine when used tongue-in-cheek, is a bit disingenuous when analyzing the game seriously, or at the very least, reductive. There's really only a handful of occasions where these three are together, and A, on the same page, and B, not dealing with some sort of threat or problem. And even moments that seem outwardly pleasant often have an undercurrent of tragedy or deception to them. At the very least, I felt the depths of these relationships more than those shared by the other major trios in the series. Right, I did that thing again where there's a smaller, more secret video before the advertised big video. I just feel that I owe it to you and the game to explain myself and my perspective before I come in arrow guns a-blazin' and shooting down certain days when it gets to be ranking time. I discussed both gameplay and story in this preamble/pre-ramble because I'll be ordering these days according to my enjoyment of them on both a gameplay and story level. Sometimes a day is all gameplay, sometimes it's all story, sometimes it's both, and where it ranks is just dependent on how much I like that day's gameplay or story elements relative to other days. Sometimes an all gameplay day will do better than an all story day, and vice versa. Great days story-wise can be dragged down by lackluster gameplay, etc., etc., anything can happen out here. Okay, I feel like we've been here long enough for this to count as a day itself, so follow me into this dark corridor as we RTC, rank the calendar days of Roxas's short-lived career.
Sea salt ice cream.
For the bottom spot, I know you want blood, and you're gonna get that blood. There are heads that need to roll, I agree. But I can't in good faith put even the most aggravating boss encounters under some of the more pointless gameplay segments with no story elements to salvage the day. So when choosing the worst day's day, I basically looked for the worst of the optional missions since they very rarely have any story stakes attached to them. For that reason, you can expect a lot of those to be clustered at the bottom here. I should note, because you can technically do several of these missions in any order when presented with a fresh batch of them, there's not really a canon day number for a lot of these missions, so whatever mission was at the top of the list Sykes gave me, I played that mission first, and I have that listed as the earliest day in a given batch, and so on and so forth. That being said, at number 100, I present Day 98. Day 98 is a Break the Pots minigame, one of two, this one being set in the Hall of Empty Melodies. The pre-mission briefing refers to it as an assessment of your luck, and it's about as dumb as that sounds. You need to break 16 of Xemnas's antique vases so Sykes can collect insurance money. But sometimes, samurais will pop out of the vases, XD so random, and you just kinda have to avoid them and keep breaking the jars. And like, what the hell, I thought the samurais were Roxas's boys, like whose payroll are they on? It just seems especially pointless, since if you die, the vases don't even reset, so you can just brute force your way through it.
Your ice cream's melting.
At number 99 is Day 227, an optional mission to Neverland with Axel to kill the Emerald Serenade. I feel like the Mount Rushmore of annoying KH enemies is composed of the Hot Rod, the Dancer, the Crimson Jazz, and the Mandrake. But the Emerald Serenade is a good candidate for, like, a Statue of Liberty, only she's giving you the finger. The Serenade's whole gimmick is that it doesn't attack, it just sticks to a set path and never stops moving. Unfortunately, it's just quick enough to evade your more conventional attacks, and it only gets faster and faster as you land more damage on it. And I get what the game wants from you here, in fact, it outright tells you, you need to set up an ambush. Chasing after it, while technically possible in some spots, is gonna take forever. Waiting for it to pass by you to land a combo while conventionally in ambush is also futile as it'll just keep floating past. So you're supposed to experiment with magic here and basically hope that the Serenade falls victim to a status effect to make it easier for you to beat it down. You could use Blazaga as a sort of mind trap or hope to hit with an arrow spell to send it flying and then launch an assault. If you're lucky, you can light it on fire and it'll do gradual damage as it makes its route. So there are ways to make it more manageable. It's something that's definitely not fun if you don't know the solution, and if you do know the solution, it's still not very fun. At the end of the day, the optimal strategy is to sit and wait for it to come to you. I just don't know if this is really the type of game for something like that. Everything just feels a bit too slow to competently and consistently set up some kind of Kevin McAllister trap for this big dumbbell or for that to feel engaging. The Serenade shows up 3 times throughout the game, and I have this Neverland iteration lowest because the route it takes feels really long and your lock-on can get messed up by the nearby turquoise marches. You can take them out, obviously, but to quote Demix, that sounds like work, which means sweating, which is gross.
Sea salt ice cream.
And I have no real reason to not put the other Serenade missions next, so at 98 is day 257, and at 97 is day 304. Day 257 is actually named Hollow, which is exactly how I felt when I realized I had to sit in a Lotus Forest with my thumb up my ass while waiting for the Emerald Serenade to float into my personal space. But I'd rather be on my feet instead of floating for this, and Zigbar is here to maybe occasionally shoot the Serenade from afar. You do also get a little cutscene of Roxas moping at the clock tower after your mission, for whatever that's worth. The Day 304 Serenade mission takes you to the Hedge Maze in Wonderland, and I find this to be the easiest one to deal with. Its altitude doesn't vary at any point, and it feels like the shortest route, so you spend much less time feeling like a dumbass as you wait for it to mosey on back to you.
Just eat your ice cream.
At number 96 is Day 226, which consists of a mission alongside Shion to Wonderland to destroy a bunch of Shadow Globs. I should say, I've identified essentially 6 categories of missions that make up the game. The most common is the Target mission, where the game gives you a specific Heartless target or targets, and the mission ends when you hunt them down. The Emerald Serenade missions all fall under that category. I count 43 days as containing Target missions. Minigames are another type, which we saw with the Break the Pots mission. There are only 5 of those by my estimation. We'll cover the rest as we get to them, but I was shocked to learn that there are only 4 Shadow Glob missions, because it feels like you do it way more often than that. I have this one lowest because we've got no story content on this day, and it just felt the most monotonous out of this category. Some Shadow Globs are out of reach and require a bit of thought, but in rooms like the Rabbit Hole or the Hedge Maze entrance, you're literally just popping pimples with no platforming or Heartless getting in your way. There's a Lurk Lizard in the Tea Party Garden, but that's about all there is of note.
I'll go buy some ice cream.
At number 95 is Day 176, which is another new type of mission, this time the Emblem Collection, which pops up 5 times, and 4 of those occasions are in optional missions. In practice, I don't hate collecting the emblems, like, it's not a painful process and you're usually done pretty quickly, but I guess from a story perspective, from an organization resource management perspective, I'm left wanting a bit more. Like, I'm not blind to the reality that these are here to add some gameplay variety, but I mean, not that much variety, right? There's only 5 of them, and they're mostly optional. And like, this is all explained by the game as a test of agility, and I'm okay with that, it makes more sense than the luck test. But what, did Saix go to Wonderland and drop little emblem icons for Roxas to collect? I mean, he doesn't do anything else besides stand there and be a professional dick. Oh, I make the schedule. Yeah, whatever, middle management, Scarface bitch. I feel the same way about the flags in Assassin's Creed, like surely this is not an efficient use of our time as a group. Anyway, this one's set in Wonderland and Luxord's there. You eat ice cream with Axel afterwards in silence. Day 76 is coming in at number 94, which is also an emblem mission, this one with Shion in Twilight Town. This one is higher because I like Twilight Town more. I guess in theory these missions are neat in that you can rarely fill the bonus gauge the first time through, so you can come back later with new movement abilities to get a better score, but it doesn't quite scratch the same itch as returning to an old location to get an out-of-reach treasure chest. That does happen sometimes in days, but often with chests that just respawn in the same spot on different missions.
Sea salt ice cream.
For number 93, we have Day 303, which is another luck test, except this time the jars are in Beast Castle, of all places. So I'm under the assumption that all of these jars are transformed people. They have no mouth, but they must scream, and they will shatter. Once again, I am amused by the prospect of giggling senior organization members sneaking into the west hall of a foreign world's castle and gingerly setting up little jars for Roxas to break to test his luck. And I'm really not stretching here, like the mission briefing acknowledges that someone in the organization prepared these jars. I'm guessing Zaldin for this one specifically, and boy will we get to that can of Lindworms later. This mission is at least notable for being the only one with living pods, which are the spookiest Search Ghost variants if you ask me. This is aided by the fact that they're incredibly fucking swole for an undead spirit and will wreck your shit really quickly if you get too close. There's also a cleverly placed jar above this door, which I like, so it's at least less straightforward than the previous jar mission.
We'll all have ice cream together.
At number 92 and 91, I'm just gonna slot in these other minigames, which are endurance tests set in the Hall of Empty Melodies on days 17 and 279. For the first one, you need to survive 1 minute with a bunch of Dusks, and for the second, it's 2 minutes with both Dusks and Samurais. These feel a bit more practical, like a more believable test of Roxas' mission capabilities, though I'm still not sure if this is the best usage of organization resources. Like, nobodies are already sort of rare, aren't they? And Roxas is just gonna kill them as a goof? Or they might kill him as a goof? Make no mistake, if the nobodies get your HP to zero during these missions, you don't strike a Sora foldy arms pose, you're just dead. And then Xemnas has to make Saix run a seminar on risk assessment. You can either fight them or try to avoid them if you're interested in keeping the nobody population stable. Day 17 does have the most awkward small talk with Axel afterwards, which plays out as follows. How's work? Going okay?
Yeah, can't complain.
That's good. As for day 279, the inclusion of the Samurais and your, by this point in the game, additional combat and movement abilities make for a more engaging round of endurance.
Ice cream?
At number 90 is day 53, which is an emblem collection mission in Agrabah. Kind of amazing that Agrabah took this long to show up, since it's the Disney World you spend the most time in. I'll talk about the world itself a bit more in depth later on, but this mission is overall fine, there's just not much to it. It's at least got the novelty of being the first of its type, and it's evident pretty quickly that you'll be able to return to this mission and tackle it more efficiently once your Roxas has grown up a bit. And I do have to respect the concept of planning out your route, even if it's not something I'm personally interested in doing. There's also a degree of strategy here in leaving some enemies alive in certain spots, as killing them resets the green ring if you're concerned about filling up the bonus gauge.
I'm sorry about the ice cream!
For number 89, we've got day 78, another Agrabah mission, this one being a team-up with Shion to take out some Shadow Globs. During this mission, I found myself wondering why it even matters to the organization that the Shadow Globs are here. The game flat-out tells you during the tutorial days that Pureblood Heartless are essentially a waste of time since they don't release hearts and thus don't contribute to the organization's goal, and the Globs are certainly not Emblem Heartless. I guess if the Shadow Globs attract Purebloods, it could mean less Emblem Heartless in a given area, which effectively makes Purebloods like crows to the organization's crops. So, in addition to being a landscaping mission, they're also pest control missions, essentially. I'm talking about the globs generally because I have nothing to say about this mission specifically. You just pop the globs throughout the city, not much more to it than that.
Man, this is some good ice cream, huh?
Our first mandatory day, day 49, comes in at number 88. Although, it's kind of a caveat, since this is a day that Roxas spends in a coma, so it's entirely cutscene-based. I can't shake the feeling that I have this either entirely too low or entirely too high, because while it doesn't actively aggravate or bore me, it is just a 50-second cutscene. But damn it, it's a cute 50-second cutscene, and maybe it's too cute to be this low and beneath some truly dreadful shit-piss bosses to come. I tried to strike a balance. By day 49, Roxas is on his 22nd full day of being asleep, and Shion has come to visit him and give him a seashell, which is very sweet. And then the camera pans out to show that she's brought him 19 other shells, and that's very fucking sweet. It's also salty because they come from the ocean. It's salty, but sweet. We also get a flashback of Sora entering his little egg pod. Can't complain too much about any of this.
I wish I had my own ice cream flavor.
And at number 87 is, maybe controversially, day 7, the first playable day. Again, sort of. In terms of player control, all you can do is walk around the gray area and talk to people until initiating the cutscene where Shion joins the organization. There's not a ton of pomp and circumstance here. I mean, they call a meeting, but it could have just been an email, and they didn't even build her a chair. Wouldn't it have been nuts if nobody knew about Shion prior to actually playing the game? Like, no trailers or interviews, she's not on the box art, she just shows up. Imagine the Metal Gear Solid 2-ification of days. Not for nothing, this is our first exposure to new areas in the castle, between Roxas's room and the gray area, featuring the most angular and uncomfortable-looking furniture known to nobody kind. You can walk around and talk to your co-workers, which is a nightmare in real life, but kind of fun here, and again, something that's lost in the movie version. Larxene will react to your lucidity with disgust, but joke's on her, she'll be dead in like 2 weeks.
We meet here for ice cream after work.
Going back to optional days, at number 86 is day 325, an emblem collecting mission in Neverland with Luxord. Besides one of Roxas's closest friends and Axel, Luxord is the only member who also gets to go to Neverland, and I choose to believe it's because time flies. Out of the missions that solely focus on emblem collection, this one is the highest on my list, and there's a reason for that. It took me the shortest amount of time to do it. But I may have even caught myself having fun flying around and grabbing emblems. There was something satisfying about this one, and you're more than capable of filling the bonus gauge on the first run without any real planning beforehand. I don't know why Luxord is here, but he's nice to me. I'm glad he came along.
I'll go get some ice cream.
It's time for some blood, people. Some mandatory boss battle blood. At number 85, we've got day 277. The mission is to eliminate a giant Heartless in Wonderland, and that Heartless turns out to be the Crimson Prankster. I should say, I don't think the Prankster is the worst boss in the game. I just think the day you fight it on and the rest of its associated mission are also pretty unremarkable. Don't get me wrong, though. This thing pisses me off. I'm not someone who ever really struggled with Trickmaster in KH1, so I'm not immediately out on the premise of two smaller Trickmasters. I mean, whoever named it might be colorblind, I'm not really getting Crimson vibes from him. Cotton Candy Prankster may have been more apt. I guess my issue with him isn't really how it fights, although it can and will fuck you five ways to Sunday against the Bizarre Room table. My issue is that I feel like my time is being wasted. I feel disrespected. Because, for the unaware, the Crimson Prankster's gimmick is that it's really two of the same Heartless, and if you kill one of them, it'll revive itself to have the same amount of HP as its still living clone. Meaning you should ideally have their HP equally depleted before landing a killing blow on one of them. So if you're unlucky enough to focus entirely on one of their copies, fuck you, I guess. And like, why wouldn't you? If I were fighting, say, Clayton and the Stealth Sneak and I have them separated, what would really compel me to keep damaging them equally? I'm just gonna focus on getting one of them out of the picture. Is this the prank part? Am I supposed to be raffling at how good they pranked me by coming back to life? I mean, I legitimately think that's what they're going for. This was the just a prank bro of Heartless. And like, good one, I guess? I wouldn't mind it if the game gave me some sort of hint beforehand that their HP was somehow tied together, but nothing about its design or the presentation of the fight or any kind of flavor text would lead anyone to believe that. It just feels like the fight is being artificially extended, and I hate that shit. It's a beginner's trap and a waste of my time. It's probably gonna take you a while to get its HP down, even if you brought along the right type of magic and keychain, and to make you do it a minimum of 3 times, assuming you catch on after the first revival, feels like a crap in my coffee, a centipede in my Snapple even. And when you finally beat it, the Cheshire Cat has the audacity to get back on his bullshit, to climb back on top of his bovine mountain of feces and give Roxas his usual nonsense. I'm fucking sick of this guy, this pseudo-philosopher, we live in a society, I'm just asking questions, bad faith feline actor. Afterwards, Roxas searches Beast Castle for Shion in a cutscene, since that's the arc during this mission, and that's the only real story content we get. You may wonder why I have this higher than the last mission, given the different tone I've taken, but I at least feel a sense of motivation and purpose for going to Wonderland to kill this thing, less so for gathering emblems.
Sea salt ice cream.
Number 84 is day 280, which brings us to the first appearance of Halloween Town on this list. It's an optional mission alongside Luxor to do some heart collection in the town square. Heart collection is the second most common mission type, with about 20 of them appearing throughout the game. I have to say, this isn't so much actively bad, I just found myself annoyed because I thought the mission was doing something sort of interesting, only for it to kind of drop the ball. The only enemies in Guillotine Square are the two big dual blades and a series of respawning creep worms. If you take out one creep worm, another one respawns, and initially it seems like you might be able to fill up the mandatory bar just by hunting down the creep worms and evading the dual blades. I thought it was a cool shakeup at first, like there's no other mission where you're hunting down weaker and more slippery enemies while avoiding stronger and bulkier ones. Instead, the bar just nearly fills, but then the creep worms stop spawning, meaning you have to kill at least one of the dual blades to satisfy the mandatory requirement. I think the mission would have been 10 times better if you could just finish it by killing creep worms, and then if you wanted the full bonuses, you could turn your attention to the dual blades. Afterwards, Roxas searches Agrabah for Shion, because this is also part of that arc, but to no avail.
He got me ice cream again.
At number 83 is day 156, an optional mission alongside Zigbar to do some heart collection in Beast Castle. Not a ton to say about this one, it's very by the books. You got 8 chests to collect, and every room of the castle is available to explore, so that's cool, but nothing too memorable otherwise. I guess the one thing is that there's a symbol monkey right in the middle of the ballroom, and I knew it was bullshit, but I just couldn't stop myself from opening it.
Having ice cream.
For number 82, it's day 323, which is called Fleeting. Another optional Zigbar mission, nothing against him though, it's just kind of unextraordinary. This is the first entry on the list in Olympus Coliseum, and this mission takes us to the arena to take out the Scorching Sphere, which is a morning star with flaming hot Cheeto dust on it. For a late game mission, it's pretty straightforward, and you've probably picked up a passing familiarity with elemental weaknesses by this point, even if this is your first ever video game. The target's name and its appearance will probably tip you off to use some blizzard magic, which makes quick work of the angry meatball. Also, Daze tells you how many treasure chests there are in a given mission. This one only has one chest, so if you open that chest and get an item, you can pretty easily ascertain that the other chest sitting right there has another one of those monkeys inside. Not this time, you little bastard.
Ice cream flavor just for you!
At number 81 is day 155, an optional mission with Zaldin to Agrabah targeting the solid armor. Once again, fairly inoffensive but no story content. You have access to the plaza, cave exterior, and the first room of the cave where the solid armor is waiting underneath its cardboard box. He's accompanied by the weaker large armors, but otherwise not much going on here. If you run out of blizzards, it sucks to be you.
Special recipe,
For number 80, we've got day 196, which is kind of a weird one. It's a solo optional mission to Twilight Town, and the objective is to collect 3 Shining Shards, and it's the only time the game asks you to gather synthesis materials. But the only things that drop Shining Shards in this mission are Guardians, and their drop rate is set to 100% for this, so the mission may as well just be kill 3 Guardians. Not bad, just weird. There's a 4th one you can hunt down if you want to fill a mission bar all the way, and a tail bunker flying around the Tram Common to spice things up, I guess.
Let's meet up for ice cream again.
Alright, we've arrived. Only elevated this high because of the pre-mission cutscene at number 79, it's day 256, news. And boy do I have some fucking news for you. I mean, not really, right? It's old. So we've all known since 2009 that the Leech Grave is one of the worst bosses to grace the series. Or what's the opposite of grace? Clunk. It has clunked the series. Leech Grave in fucking deed. It's a leech on your time and it makes you yearn for an early grave. There are certain things fans complain about that annoy me and I usually take the contrarian stance on. Donald healing, Terra dumb, etc. Not this time. I'm fully ready to get in normie lockstep with everyone else. This is shit. And it really didn't have to be. To be honest, if the mission was just show up, go to the next room, and fight the Leech Grave, it'd be fine. Still probably annoying, but not notorious. But as it stands, the Leech Grave is just this insufferable bummer. It demands either extreme luck or saintly patience. And when I say luck, I don't mean that the fight is unfair or that you needed roll doubles to make it through in one piece. It's only if you happen to come prepared. If you're lucky enough to roll up to the fight with the right kit that you may not have to withdraw from the mission and try again. It's either that or you slowly engage in a war of attrition, and neither of these things are fun or well designed. Let's just reset for a sec. The Leech Grave is the big entity that's caused the decline in the Heartless population throughout Halloween Town, and I'll give it points for that. It's a cannibal Heartless, and you don't really get any other glances at a Heartless food chain or ecosystem. It lies at the center of the Manor Ruins, and on your way there you have to dispatch its many tentaclaws, first in the town square and again at the Moonlight Hill. But you'll find, as I found, that trying to take down these claws with aerial combos is like trying to shave your face with a fucking spoon. You might dish out 3 swings and manage to connect with 0 of them if your combo is especially unsuited for how the claws move, but fine, at least in the first area you can use the little pumpkin bombs lying around to damage the claws from a distance. Even still, it won't be enough to take them all down. But if you try out your magic, you'll find that fire can pretty reliably take off a lot of its HP, so let the fires rip. For the second round of claws at the hill, there's no pumpkin bomb assistance, but whatever, fire does the job anyway, and it's a lot quicker. Then you get to the actual ruins. The Leech Grave is situated in the middle, and it's surrounded by 4 claws, though it felt like fucking 9 of them in the moment. I could not believe it was only 4 when I went back and looked at the footage. You can attack the Leech Grave directly, but after just a few swings, it'll counter with an incredibly punishing attack that can take you out insanely quickly, regardless of the difficulty you're playing on. And unlike with the claws, using fire or any other magic on the core grave does nothing, so that plans out. So obviously the game's intent is for you to take out the tentaclaws, which stuns the Leech Grave for a bit, giving you an opening to pile on damage. Of course, after a little while, the Leech Grave rallies and the claws grow back and you'll have to rinse and repeat. Again, in theory, all of this is fine. The boss's attacks, whether they're coming from the grave itself or the tentaclaws, are not super unpredictable or even that damaging outside of that counter move. It's that the earlier parts of the mission have set you up for failure at worst or a complete slog at best. By the first time you've reached the Leech Grave itself, if you're lucky, you have a few fires left, assuming you even had any equipped to begin with. Even with a bunch of ethers or high ethers, even if you also happen to have some blizzards with you as well, which do similar amounts of damage but are less precise, it's just not going to be enough to reliably get through the fight at a reasonable pace. So you're inevitably going to run out of magic and items if you even had those tools left by now, and there's no gradual magic restoration like in other titles, so then you're forced into an agonizing game of whack-a-claw. And unless you're playing perfectly or with an enlightened level of patience, you're eventually just gonna get whittled down to nothing after getting caught in occasional attacks, or you'll do what I did and say fuck this and withdraw from the mission early so you can come back with a better panel setup. And even this, which sucks in case you forgot, I'm still willing to forgive. Like, it ain't ideal, but I can respect going into a mission, realizing you're ill-equipped, and retreating in order to better prepare. But it's not like you can just fix up your shit and then plop back into the boss proper. No, of course you have to... What was the word I used before? Clunk? Let's beef that up. Of course, you have to clunk fuck your way through those 2 batches of claws before the actual fight. And so now that you know what's coming, that you need to stockpile all your fires for the boss itself, you'd be silly to use a bunch of them on these pre-game claws. Go ahead, use a few if you want, but you'll be sorry when you're running around during the boss fight all out of magic because a few of your fires whiffed when the tentaclaws burrow and teleport. So ensues hitting the pre-boss claws with your unreliable air combos in order to conserve your magic at the cost of your time and sanity. I don't know about you, but I'd rather go out in my backyard and count the dog turds. The whole thing is just putrid and cruel. It begs you to fail and to waste your time, and it isn't even your fault. It is, once again, a beginner's trap. It trains you to resort to magic before you get to the fight, and then it fucking laughs at you when you run out of it. And unlike some other better days that might sprinkle in some magic restoring items throughout a mission that's very magic-centric, this one just throws synth materials at you. Unless you have prior knowledge of how the mission works, or you don't mind burning elixirs or a shitload of high ethers, your arm is twisted, caught in a Xemnas Kyrie wrist grab to play at least one part of this mission in the most monotonous way, only after being manipulated by the game at least once and facing a prolonged death or undergoing a premature evacuation. Even with all the magic you need to do the fight comfortably, it's still a fucking chore. You only have a small window to do real damage against the grave, and like every other thing that breathes in this game, it has entirely too much fucking health. I guess a diet of other Heartless makes you strong. Now imagine trying to play this on a hot and sunny day on the school bus after a rough day at middle school while a kid two seats in front of you throws an Uncrustable at the back window while screaming something that is not a language. Anyway, I don't like it. As I said up top, the only thing keeping this above the Crimson Prankster and a bunch of the optional missions is the story content. The day kicks off with a morning meeting where Xemnas reveals that Shion has run away, and we get some fun interactions there. But at the end of the mission, to add insult to injury, Lock, Shock, and Barrel, for like the fourth or fifth time, pull an epic prank on Roxas by throwing a bomb at his face. And Roxas, the poor fuck, he falls for it every time by being a person standing there with a face. The one piece of joy I got out of the mission itself was the scarecrow that Jack made of Roxas. It is the only scrap of light in my dark. Jesus Christ, Leechgrave. Leechgrave got 5 minutes out of me.
Rockin' Crunch Ice Cream!
Back to optional days, at number 78 is day 54, which takes you to Agrabah to kill a bunch of deserters. I mean, I guess in this case, they're deserters. Yeah, I can pivot from clunk fuck to shitty puns real quick. The deserter is a variant on the soldier that I guess went AWOL, reflected by its tendency to spend more time avoiding combat than engaging Roxas. I don't really mind these encounters, though this one in particular was a bit much for my totally legitimate Nintendo DS to handle. They scatter around the area like roaches, but thankfully go down easy to either magic or a single combo. When you kill one, the rest get really pissed, which I guess is kind of sweet. I also hate it when my friends are killed. They'll try to swarm you all at once, but you can block them to give yourself an opening. Or just take the hits and keep swinging like a barbarian, aka me.
Get the ice cream later!
And it makes sense to me to place the other two optional deserter missions here as well, so at number 77 and 76 are days 278 and 121. Day 278 sends you to Beast Castle with Axel. This time, the conscientious objectors are in the entrance hall and are guarded by a barrier master that you need to take out first. I'll talk more about this guy in a higher ranked day. Thankfully, during this mission, my official Nintendo DS had an easier time handling the amount of enemies and explosions of money and HP prizes. On the way back to the dark corridor, an invisible shows up in the ballroom, and these guys are essentially mini-bosses in this game. Unfortunately, I decided to fight it, ignorant to the fact that these bastards are even more obnoxious here than they were in KH1, turning into their sword every time you look at them the wrong way and prolonging the fight for way past its expiration date. When I finally took it down, I didn't even know what item it dropped because the game was giving me the RTC message again, and I guess it can't handle two notifications at the same time, so I was annoyed about that. Then Roxas sulked in Halloween Town because he's looking for Shion. We're back in that arc again. Day 121 brings us to Olympus Coliseum on our own to take out some deserters in the arena. Until now, I've neglected to mention that you get to listen to Rowdy Rumble each time you have a deserter mission. These guys are really encroaching on Pete's territory. After killing the deserters here, I took a moment to note the novelty of just hanging out and having free roam in the empty arena. I guess Phil forgot to lock up and fucking anything goes in here after closing time.
How about a sea salt ice cream then?
At number 75 is day 52, which is called Solitude. The mission is an optional one to Twilight Town on your own to take out the Tailbunker. He's basically a beefier and greener wyvern, and you fight him in the Tram Common area. I don't really know if you'd categorize this as a boss, like it feels more substantial than a Zip Slasher, but not as much as something like Leechgrave or the Pranksters. It goes down fairly easy. My one note was that it makes a screeching noise in its cutscene, which is actually kind of abnormal for a Heartless. They tend to not make noises.
Favorite flavors of ice cream.
For number 74, this is actually the last optional mission in the game, day 326. This one sends you to Halloween Town to kill three Windstorms, which are also bigger and greener wyvern variants. All three are fought in the town square, and it can get pretty hectic since there are also some detonators that keep respawning for a bit. I thought maybe they were meant to help speed up the fight by blowing them up near the windstorms, but that didn't seem to do much. I did have to change my panels entirely for this one, since they only seemed to take any decent damage from thunder spells, but it was easy enough once I was well prepared. See, with something like this, I don't mind not coming to the field with the right stuff, unlike with the Leechgrave mission, because the task at hand is like one room away, I can withdraw, change up my panels, and get right back into it. Also, my hunt for the remaining treasures led me to the graveyard where there's an invisible that I did not fuck with at all. Already learned that lesson.
Did you know you should be checking your ice cream sticks?
At number 73 is the mercifully short and simple Day 197, which sends you to Neverland to kill an avalanche. I prefer Barret and Tifa. This is yet another big wyvern subspecies, this one being blue. It's honestly a coincidence that a bunch of them are grouped up like this. If you take a handful of fire panels, this is over in under 2 minutes. And I leaned heavy into fire during my playthrough, even without bothering to level them up, and this was still a cakewalk. We take those. At number 72 is a mandatory day amidst a sea of optional ones, Day 225, Quietude. I was actually like 10 entries higher into writing the list when I realized that I let this one slip way too high up because I remember actively disliking most of this mission. Roxas shows up to Halloween Town alone with orders to kill the carrier ghost. Upon strolling through the corridor, he gets pranked once again by Lock, Shock, and Barrel. Fucking hilarious, you guys, well done. Then we overhear Jack and Dr. Fink talking about these dumbass blue pumpkins that Jack put together. Can I just say, I'm not at all impressed by Jack in this game. Like, he's so hard pressed for ideas on how to make Halloween super spooky this year, and he comes up with ice pumpkins and bug balloons. I'm sure he's been at this for potentially thousands of years as an undead monarch of gourds, but is this really what we're landing on? While not scary in the slightest, you can use the pumpkins against the hover ghost in the graveyard to help hasten that fight. Afterwards, you have to light some lanterns at the Curly Hill to open the other boneyard where the carrier ghost is, and that fight is abysmal. It's just another one of those enemies that has entirely too much health for what it is and what it's capable of, and it just gets to be a bore. I don't know if this is universal, but I'd hit it with air combos and it would just keep rising out of reach, so then I was forced to sit around like, you guessed it, a dumbass while I waited for it to descend. Once it's finally dealt with, you're treated to a scene of the middle school dropouts trembling in fear at an even shittier boss, one of the Leechgrave's tentaclaws. You have to take it out before you RTC, so I guess I can at least appreciate the foreshadowing and continuity. Even the plot stuff for this day felt weak though. RXA are all being weirdo with each other at this point, so at the clock tower, Shion does a grand total of no things and then leaves Roxas alone. Axel shows up and Roxas says he's worried about Shion, Axel says she'll be fine, great convos, guys. The one thing of interest is that we see Shion being a hacker at the end. She's Kairi's Mr. Robot. That joke is for me and like four of you.
Should've brought some ice cream.
Coming in at number 71 is the completely whelming Day 100, which ends up being an optional solo mission to Bee's Castle to do heart collection. This one was mostly notable for me for introducing massive possessors, which are large fart clouds that burst into smaller fart clouds upon defeat. The possessors in general can be real bastards, they just sort of glom onto you and you can lose a huge chunk of HP pretty quickly without even really noticing. This mission is also the first appearance of icy cubes and their larger snowy crystal variant. These guys kind of force you into using either magic or aerial combos, since you'll get frozen pretty easily if you try to engage them head on while grounded. I'll tend to rank missions that introduce new enemies a bit higher if only for the freshness and novelty, so long as they're not obnoxious. And we get some wordless ice cream with the gang afterwards. Another optional mission here at number 70, it's Day 258. Same mission parameters as the last one, except in Agrabah. The enemies here mainly consist of solid armors grouped up with loudmouths, which can be annoying since the latter will heal the former and each other. But it does ask for a bit of strategy and an order of operations, which is appreciated over just mashing through Heartless. It also really demands that you search every corner to even fill the bar, let alone the bonus gauge, and I tend to like it when the missions require a bit of thoroughness.
Meet up there for ice cream.
At number 69 is Day 122, an optional mission with Zigbar to kill a Morning Star in Olympus Coliseum. The star is in the arena accompanied by a bunch of Lil Cannons, which are just renamed cannon guns from KH2, and I'm just now realizing that. Days does that, it changes the names of a bunch of Heartless, and I'm sure there's a reason, but I don't know it. Honestly, this one's only this high because I was able to farm a bunch of gear component A's, which, let's face it, is the oldest American pastime. You can really rack up a bunch of them since the cannons spawn in over and over. At the end of the day, Roxas and Shion have some ice cream. That's it.
Who else will I have ice cream with?
For number 68, I've got Day 175, which is an optional mission with Demix to Halloween Town to take out a Dual Blade. Also, I promise we've almost burned through most of the optional missions. The real video is starting soon. Nearly 40 minutes in. For this one, I just like the novelty of having a boss or mini-boss in the town square, since this was the first mission to have that. Plus, there are very few opportunities where Demix actually sticks around to fight alongside you, and this is one of them.
Such delicious. delicious ice cream.
For number 67, it's day 79. This one is an optional mission with Shion to Beast Castle to do heart collection. I guess this mission is notable for introducing Cogsworth and the pseudo-stealth element of having to avoid his gaze while you kill Heartless, so that's something. He's no Lumiere though. Lumiere is my mortal enemy, so this is a bit of a cooldown from that. It's kind of neat that they introduce a character in an optional mission so that at least sets it apart a bit. Other than that, it's very by the books.
Not if you explode from all that ice cream first.
At number 66 is day 15. Give it up for day 15! Day 15 is called Missions, which feels like an optional mission, but is actually mandatory. This one partners you up with Larxene and sends you to Twilight Town to eliminate some Watchers. I want you all to know that I would never eliminate any of my Watchers. There's no in-mission dialogue or cutscenes though, so it really feels like a bunch of the optional team-up missions we've covered already. At the very least, it's a Larxene team-up, and we don't get a ton of those given her impending murder at the hands of Roxas' other half. There is at least some fun dialogue in the gray area before leaving, where Larxene hints that maybe her and Marley should have let Roxas in on the CO plan, stopping herself before giving too much away. So I thought that was neat. But beyond that, you're just killing Watchers throughout the town with the forced fight in the Sandlot and a certified ice cream moment with Roxas and Axel afterwards.
You remember what this ice cream is called?
At number 65, I'm slotting in our next cutscene-only day, which is day 50, Familiar Sound, aka the day Roxas wakes up from his coma. Again, maybe a bit high for a day where you don't actively do anything, but it's cute to see Roxas and Shion reunite after Roxas' big nap. The day actually kicks off with an auditory flashback of Kairi's first line from KH1, so that obviously gives the day a bump for me. Though the line is clearly not how Hayden said it in the first game, but I don't mind it being a new Alison Stoner recording of it since she also voices Shion. The day bookends with another flashback, this time a visual one of Sora and Kairi at the pier, triggered when Roxas listens to one of the seashells Shion brought him. Roxas really lucked out because it seemed like he woke up after the workday was already over, so he just went right to the clock tower. You know that if he happened to snap out of it at like 8 AM, Sykes was sending his ass on a mission. At number 64 is day 301, Vacant Place. You were probably wondering where Ruler of the Sky was this whole time. I guess I'll step out of line with this one. I don't think it's the worst or even the second worst boss in the game. I still don't think it's great or super fun, but I'd rather fight this than the other two major bosses we've covered already. Give me two Rulers of the Sky before one Leech Grave. Plus, Ruler doesn't force you through a bunch of mini-encounters and waste your time or get your hopes up. Granted, it is a long fight, but I felt on both of my most recent playthroughs that it's entirely doable the first time you face it, even without prior knowledge or preparation. I definitely benefited from having a magic-heavy build, though, and trying to chase down the Ruler with physical combos is gonna make the fight take even longer. But if you can get in front of it with a few fires, you can take out its tail pieces pretty quickly, and its big Gatling gun can be nearly invalidated by just getting close to it, and then it's wide open for attack. I'll say this though, it charges around way too quickly and that can really catch you off guard. Plus, you'll find yourself flying headfirst into icicles thanks to the small screen. Obviously, it sucks to make it far into this fight and then fail, but at least you can jump right back into it. But don't get me wrong, it's still boring and not super well designed, especially if you're running a physical strength build. This mission also brings resolution to the Hook plotline, whose ship gets wrecked by the Ruler's corpse, and I'm assuming he just gives up piracy after that. This is the latest in the timeline we see Neverland, so that's where his story ends, I guess. This is also where Pete's involvement in the story ends, if you could even call it that. Kinda weird that he's only in Agrabah and Neverland, but I guess it fleshes out what he was doing during KH1 and afterwards. I should also say, I have no idea how flying works in this game. Tinkerbell needed to reapply the dust when Roxas showed up, but what about all those other times where Roxas entered the world and could fly from the start? Anyway, Roxas sits alone at the clock tower and thinks about how fucking long his day was.
A special recipe ice cream.
Number 63 is day 324, a nameless but mandatory day whose mission sends you to Wonderland for heart collection. It's a lot like that Larxene mission from earlier that kind of feels optional. This one has you hunting down a bunch of prismatic melodies, and I tend to like those guys if you hadn't noticed the mascot. It's another one where you really have to search every nook and cranny to fill up the gauge, which I thought was kind of fun. Afterwards, Roxas sits alone and mopes a bit.
Eat ice cream together.
At number 62 is day 16, the first optional mission, and oddly one of the most memorable missions in the game for me. It's for traumatic reasons, though. So this mission is alongside Marluxia in Twilight Town for some basic heart collection. For me, this one is notorious for the zip slasher that shows up after you fill the gauge enough to complete the mission. I must have thrown myself at this thing at least a dozen times when I first played it as a kid, oblivious to the idea that you're supposed to come back to this one later. Granted, you very well can beat the zip slasher your first time through, it just takes a lot of time and patience. I recommend throwing on a podcast or maybe some old Twitch playthroughs, I don't know. I did, for the first time ever, manage to defeat the Slasher at the earliest opportunity, so this was a big moment for me. It's also the first time you have free range over the entirety of Twilight Town, and one of two Marluxia missions, the only non-tutorial one, so you gotta savor the hair while you can.
Didn't he sell ice cream?
Our last optional mission for a while at number 61 is Day 99. The mission sends you to Agrabah to kill some Aerial Masters, featuring some well-deserved
Demix time!
The mission itself is fine, you're basically just running around the big desert ruins area. I just like the clock tower conversation, since you usually don't get those on optional mission days. We're in the wake of Shion getting her Keyblade back, so they're just chatting about if everything is still holding up well. Shion thanks Roxas and Axel for helping her, and Axel gets embarrassed, and they tease him a bit. It's cute.
Double Crunch Ice Cream!
Back to tutorial missions, at number 60 is Day 13, Deeds to be Done, aka the day Lexius knocks Roxas the fuck out. Lexius woke up in his flat and pointy bed and chose child abuse. You may be realizing that I've saved all of the tutorial missions for this high up, but I put a lot of stock into Roxas learning the ropes of the job and the existential or non-existential realities he comes face to face with. On top of that, the game is squeezing in some time with the ill-fated Castle Oblivion crew, who, I'll remind you, are all murdered by Roxas's other half, Roxas's best friend, or Roxas's other half's best friend. Gameplay-wise, this is just a tutorial for learning limit breaks, initiated by Lexius's earth-shattering backhand, which is probably to date his biggest moment in the series. You have to wonder if maybe this lesson could have been folded into another quick Sandlot mission just from a time management perspective. We see a spark of early morality from Roxas here, where he asks Lexius if the deeds he must do are good deeds, and Lexius is like, yeah, I mean, for us. Roxas reflects that the group has good apples and bad apples, but are the good apples not sort of complicit to the bad apples' behavior as evidenced by their inaction? Just something to think about.
No more ice cream for you.
At number 59 is the previous day, day 12, A Closed World. It's notably the most uncomfortable start to any of the days. Vexen says, you're mine today, Roxas. And Roxas says, okay. Feel like Roxas should probably pack some pepper spray on some of these missions. We've actually gone this far into the list without a recon mission, and this is the first one of those out of about six. I feel like these are probably unpopular, they move a bit slower and aren't intrinsically focused on combat, but I always found them to be a refreshing change of pace. I do think they'd be more interesting in environments that I'm not familiar with, and DayZ is not exactly leading the charge when it comes to that, assuming you've played everything in release order. You go around and examine points of interest, and Roxas chats about it, and Vexen is brutal to him the whole time. Little steps for little minds is something I'll have to use more often. I think the recon missions really flesh out the organization a bit more, or at least their day-to-day business. It makes sense that they scout out a world and gather intel before ramping up operations there. In this case, it also makes Twilight Town feel even more lived in, despite nobody being around outside of HPO on occasion. Also, Roxas seems to be surprised to learn that there's more than one world, despite having been to two by this point, so Vexen might be onto something with that little minds thing. Bonus points for this day being home to the famous Lurk Scene's a Witch line from Demix.
Let's get some ice cream.
Keeping with the tutorial missions, at number 58 is Day 9, Heartless. This is another quick Sandlot mission, this time with Marluxia as your partner in his most significant appearance in the game. All things considered, he's pretty friendly with Roxas, albeit possibly because he's thinking about using him as a tool against the organization, like he'll attempt to do with Sora in a few weeks. You can tell when he's marveling at the Keyblade that he's considering Roxas as a backup plan of sorts. Beyond that, Marley stands there while you do all the work, but I just thought it was fun to see him. And this mission gives us the moment where Roxas realizes how he's pretty much the most important person in the organization, given that nothing has been accomplished as far as Kingdom Hearts is concerned until he got here. I should also mention, this mission introduces the lock-on system, which I did not cover in my dedicated lock-on video, but I'm willing to say that Day's lock-on is better than KH2's and Dream Drop's. It's still not great, but double-tapping R and switching with a single tap is way more intuitive and easy to remember than the completely batshit combo that those other games use that I already, and thankfully, forgot.
Axel brought me here to eat ice cream.
Coming in at number 57 is Day 27, our next cutscene day titled The Dark Margin, which is the first day of Roxas' coma. It kicks off with a callback cutscene of Roxas and Xemnas soaking up rays on the beach, and then we get Xemnas and Saix watching Roxas as he sleeps. You know, because they care and are worried about him. Basically, anytime I get to see organization scheming, I'm gonna be high on that. Their convo also teases out some information about Shion's role in the organization, as we learn that Shion gaining power was part of the organization's plans and supposedly had been all along. And talk about the chamber? I eat that shit up like sea salt ice cream. A lot of people are down on the Chamber of Waking and all of that because it doesn't quote-unquote go anywhere, but I don't know, I don't think it needed to go any further than it did. It's just the Terranor and, by extension, Terra part of Xemnas who feels some connection to Aqua and Ven. It's like an errant fascination that he has. For me, it's just some fun foreshadowing like the 2FM scene and creates some connective tissue for this batch of games from 2005 to 2010. I gotta say though, this would have been a great time to use the track Xemnas while Xemnas is on screen. They only play it when he's not around for some reason.
It's just the ice cream machine!
Number 56 gives us yet another mandatory but nameless day in Day 154, which is also a solo mission to Wonderland for Heart Collection, though this is the first time visiting the world. It plays out strikingly similarly to Sora's trip to Wonderland, between the White Rabbit having a panic attack in the rabbit hole and the doorknob advising each of them to drink the suspicious bottle to shrink down. The game knows this as it gives us a staticky flashback of Sora running around in the rabbit hole where you're actually controlling both characters. Basically, anytime the game gives you one of these, the day shoots up a couple spots higher than it probably deserves to. It's such a genius use of the bottom screen, and they don't overuse it, so it's always so fun when it happens. The mission boils down to hunting more Prismels in the Bazaar Room, parentheses fuck the Sapphire Elegies, and then a Lurk Lizard shows up as a mini-boss. I also kind of like these lizard enemies. They turn invisible on occasion, and you can track their movement with the map, which is at least something different. Overall, it's a solid day for the bottom screen. We also get Roxas being a big grumpy Gus on the clock tower, like he's a total brick wall with Axel here. And then they eat ice cream awkwardly because, like, they bought the ice cream before they knew the vibes here were gonna be dog shit. And if you take it back to the castle, everyone's gonna be pissed off that you didn't bring them any, so you kinda have to finish it here, otherwise it's a whole thing.
Once you finish your ice cream...
Back over to tutorials, it's day 11, Keyblade at number 55. This is your designated Lark scene mission, and boy does she not lay off for even half a second. I guess I have this mission ranked pretty highly for one that Larxene refers to as, and I quote, awful, for babies, and the worst mission ever. She also makes the only reference to feces in the series, at least as far as I'm aware, when she uses the phrase deep doo-doo. I used the Wayfinder project to search that, along with crap, shit, and turds, and I found nothing. I did get a lot of poo, though. I'll be honest, I just found this mission funny, and it's once again the only moment of substance Roxas gets with yet another comm victim, so it stands out for me. I think literally all but one or two of Larxene's text bubbles include some sort of insult or annoyance at the situation. The mission itself is just teaching you how to use magic, so you get to control a Keybladeless Roxas for a bit and shoot fire out of your hand. I also learned from Keynote during this playthrough that if you manage to miss every time, Larxene scolds you and makes you do it again. You can only see it the first time through, since you can just withdraw if you do it as a holo mission, so it's a fun little detail. Day 11 is also the first day the game lets you edit your panels, which you'll find ends up being like Roxas's morning coffee, for better or worse. Wake up, ponder non-existence, take a shit but don't have to wipe because you're a nobody, rearrange your panels, and go out on your mission. The panel system gets a lot of flack, some fair and some unfair. In theory, I think it's really fun that you're forced to pick and choose what you want to stock up on and prioritize, but it can be super annoying when you get a new skill and have to rearrange everything top to bottom just to add in one new thing. I wouldn't mind seeing it come back with some extra quality of life features in some sort of side game, but I also won't be mad if it's a one-off.
The ice cream.
For number 54, I have Day 23, Silent Companion. Might be a bit low considering it's the first team-up mission you have with Shion, but not a ton of pieces are moving here, it's just more of a setup day. Gotta spend a little bit of time with her first, so it hits harder when she finally speaks up. She spends the entire day hooded and, as you might guess, silent. She doesn't have her Keyblade yet at this point, but she will cast fire or stand there and get hit, whichever she's feeling at the moment. The mission is to kill a poison plant in the underground concourse, which goes down pretty easily no matter how you handle it. When the mission's done, Roxas tells Shion to RTC without him, as he has very important Roxas business to attend to. This day also gets some points for the opening scene, which features Saix essentially ordering the hit on the CO traitors, though Axel ends up killing the ones who were actively combating the traitors, so I guess this order really was straight from Lord Xemnas' lips, and the murders Axel carries out are the off-screen Saix orders. Regardless, anytime you see Axel walking alone in a hallway and then Saix shows up, you know you're about to get a fucking awesome conversation about conspiratorial or ulterior motive shit. I'm just a really big fan of subterfuge.
One bowl of ice cream coming right up!
At number 53 is Day 224, titled Anomaly. This one was a bit of a mixed bag for me, some really cool stuff and some things that got on my nerves a little. Your goal in the day's mission is to enter the games at the Colosseum and take out the Heartless there, but there's a bit of a wrinkle to it. Well, first off, the biggest story here, this is the nicest Saix is to Roxas in the entire game. He pairs you up with Demix and suggests that Roxas can inspire him with his work ethic. I mean, we'll take it, work is the only thing Saix has any vested interest in, so it must mean something coming from him. I guess it's not that inspiring though, since Demix hangs back immediately upon arrival. I appreciate it though, it's in character and it makes sense that Demix would weasel his way out of the assignment whenever he can. I ran up to Phil while on fire, spoke to him, entered the games, and then continued to be on fire. I like how the games are handled in Days. The arena actually changes from round to round to spice things up a bit. It's nothing crazy, but it beats the same flat surface every time. I feel like Cage 1 or 2 totally could have had something like this, so I wonder if they just didn't think to do it until Days. After tearing through the mooks, Phil talks about the other finalist, and I genuinely forgot who it was, so I was pleasantly surprised to see Zigbar entered the games as well. Not to brush by the fact that Phil also teaches Roxas religion. Anyway, I shot Zigbar with two fires and the match ended, so I don't even really know what he's capable of in this fight. What's crazy is that he gets Rowdy Rumble for his battle track too. You fight Lushu to Rowdy Rumble in 2009. That's nuts. Afterwards, the guard armor plops in, and I have to say, I really don't care for it. I do love the bottom screen flashback to it appearing in Traverse Town in Cage 1, accompanied by a few double playable moments where you control Roxas above and Sora below. Honestly, it's the best usage of the feature in the game for my money. I mean, you can make Sora do things he couldn't do during that part of Cage 1, like glide or use fire, but I accept the artistic license being taken here. My problem is that since the game is intentionally reminding you of Cage 1, I wouldn't really blame you for trying to handle the boss in the same way, but it's a fair amount different in Days. Unlike in 1, you're expected to attack the head, and it takes absurdly low damage from magic, so you basically have to resort to aerial combos, which is slow and awkward. Or at least it was with the Keyblade I brought, and I wasn't about to withdraw and go through all of the games again. Eventually, when you manage to knock the head onto the ground, you can get some easier combos on it, or you'd hope, since you might manage to clank off of its limbs' wonky hitboxes. Then you can target the limbs, but they regenerate, unlike in 1. I don't mind changing things up, but when you're throwing these Cage 1 callbacks in my face, like literally showing me that game on another screen, you're kind of conditioning me to approach the battle in a similar way. It's also kind of weird that they repurposed a very early boss from Cage 1 at like the 2/3 point of this game. On top of that, it lacks theming or a tie-in to the world unlike some worse bosses, it just drops in without explanation. It's not awful, but it's a bit of a slog. Once again, it's not really a matter of the boss being difficult or hard to survive, it's just slow. There is a funny bit afterwards where Phil finally realizes that he's been training some, for lack of a better word, nobody and not the trainee that Hercules scouted. Days has some really fun camera work for the record, in both comedic moments like this and more dramatic stuff later on. After the mission, we have our first canonical near fall off the clock tower as Shion's been raiding Demix's stash of high ethers again. It's a stressful job, I don't blame her. Somehow, Roxas and Axel don't go, "Holy fucking shit, you almost fell off the fucking clock tower and died, Jesus Christ, maybe we shouldn't sit up here every day." Axel then formulates the plan of going to the beach, which is tragic if you know how this game ends, and even more tragic if you know how Cage 2 goes. Less tragic if you've beaten Cage 3.
And some of the wise loved ice cream.
Jumping back to a tutorial mission for number 52, it's day 10, Incomplete. This one sends you to the Tram Common for the first time and teams you up with Zexion, who I thought was fairly chill, but is actually a total dick. It's not like Larxene, who's directly verbally abusive, or Lexius, who causes Roxas bodily harm. Zexion basically guilt trips you if you try to complete the mission without filling the bonus gauge. He's got big Gen Z just doesn't want to work energy. It's like working at a job and being accused of not caring about the company if you never stay late. No shit, I don't care about the company, I care about ice cream. You all need me, I'll kill things at my own pace. Oh, maybe Xemnas will give me a gift card to Panera if I really put in the extra effort, like fuck off. Anyway, totally unrelated, but it was during this mission that I realized Days will show you the name of the enemy that you're targeting, and I think that's really neat. I feel like a lot of players never learn the Heartless names, and that's a good way to help make that easier. That didn't factor into where this day ranked, I just thought I'd mention it. This mission is your first real heart collection, and it's fine for that, but I mostly just enjoyed the conversation between Roxas and Zexion before RTC. Somehow, Roxas didn't know until day 10 that he didn't have a heart, which weighs heavily on him. I'm sure that would weigh heavily on me too if he told me that when I was 10 days old. I'd probably cry and shit myself if I heard that. This day is really when the game starts building Roxas' struggle with identity. Obviously, we know in hindsight that he and his friends really were feeling emotions and that the whole no hearts for nobody's thing was BS, but it's still a poignant inner conflict. Being told what you are or what you're supposed to be is unfortunately an all too familiar hardship that a lot of people, especially kids who are likely playing this game after some rough days at middle school, have gone through. So it's no wonder that so many players found this game and Roxas especially relatable. Roxas also has to grapple with essentially being touted as the potential savior of the organization, being the only person who's capable of restoring their hearts. For now, of course.
The three of us can have ice cream.
At number 51 is day 77, an unnamed but mandatory day featuring a recon mission to Beast Castle with Shion. It's nothing crazy, but it's a good sort of team-building exercise. Again, normally awful in the real world, but fun in video game land. This mission is the one that introduces the Lumiere stealth stuff, which is easy to deal with for most people, but can be difficult if you're a terminal dumbass like me. Ultimately, I can appreciate the wrinkle in the gameplay here, even though I will full-on charge into his vision cone, learn nothing from it, and then do it again. How do they know that the world is called Beast Castle, by the way? Is that what the address says when you look at it on Moogle Maps? How does Roxas know what a candelabra is while occasionally failing to understand much simpler nouns and concepts without having them explained to him? This mission raised a lot of questions for me, and I respect that.
I'm gonna miss this ice cream thing we do.
At the middle point of our journey, number 50 is day 120. I'm gonna be honest, I had this day fucking ridiculously high for some reason. Before I started writing, I made a Google sheet and ordered the days, and this ended up in like the low 30s. I looked at my footage and my notes, and I have no idea why. My only theory is that I was enamored with this Sora flashback moment during the clay armor fight where Sora's on the bottom screen fighting soldiers. It's the first time the game does it that way, and clearly it left an impression on me, but I have no idea how I expected to justify having it that high. The day is literally nameless and is otherwise just a round of heart collection in Olympus. You fight some flare notes, Phil brings you into the arena to deal with the clay armor, you play a barrel minigame, and Hercules shows up too late to be useful. That's literally it. I mean, it's fun enough, nothing about it is painful, but there's no plot afterwards, just wordless ice cream with Shion, so it's a perfectly middle-of-the-road mission in the middle of the list.
Sea salt ice cream.
For number 49, we have another Shion mission, which takes place on day 24, Silence Broken. You'll never guess what happens in this one. It's your second mission with Shion, and after bonding over the experience of thrashing a bunch of deserters to Rowdy Rumble, she builds up the confidence to speak. At least, I assume that's what happened. It could be that the vocal cords are the last things to grow in when you're a replica. I'm not a scientist. Obviously, it's nothing huge, it's just like the other deserter missions we already covered, but it's the start of Roxas' and Shion's relationship. Though, in truth, the best part of the day might be the pre-mission chat right here. What a powerful little group. I want to see these four go out on a mission together. It's a shame we never got to explore more combinations of members, because this scene had me imagining all sorts of different arrangements. Imagine being with both Lorxine and Demix on a target mission. For all his faults, Syx probably knows better than to draft the schedule that way.
One bowl of ice cream coming right up!
Coming in at number 48 is day 75, Inseparable. This is yet another Shion mission, this one sending you to Agrabah to do recon in the cave. This day is a few days after a similar mission with Axel, which we'll get to in a bit. Honestly, I prefer the gameplay portion of this Shion mission, but that Axel mission has some more interesting story bits. I think the Shion mission suffers a little for coming so soon after the Axel one. It's a little fatiguing hitting on a lot of the same beats in the environmental sense, a lot of the same block pushing and platforming, which is fine, just a bit repetitive so soon after. The day kicks off with Roxas and Shion begging Syx to let them go on the mission together, which has big trying to convince mom to let my friend sleep over vibes. And then Axel, the dad, manages to change Syx's mind. We're at the point in the story where Shion forgets how to Keyblade, so this is the first time they're able to enact Operation Double Duty, which is not the same kind of duty that Lorxine talked about earlier. The mission starts with Abu being bullied by Scarlet Tangos, which you might feel bad about in 2009, but you may want to join in on the bullying after experiencing the Agrabah missions of the mobile games. And for the record, when Roxas and Shion take out the Heartless, they don't reference doing so because a little monkey is being attacked, it's just because it's their job. They feel nothing for him. Abu leaves behind a gumball, which you use to progress further into the cave. The cave is a mixed bag, and by this point you've already done most of it, so I'll cover that later. This mission adds in this whole segment of backtracking to hit a couple of blocks to raise platforms to progress. Nothing revolutionary, but it encourages a bit of exploration, which I tend to like. The mission caps off with a Pete battle, which is sort of a watered-down version of his Cage 2 appearances. I was more than happy to bludgeon him after the last time we saw him, which, again, we'll get to. On the way back, Roxas and Shion meet Genie and Carpet, the latter thinking Roxas is Sora, I guess because he has no eyes, but Sora and Roxas smell the same? Because rugs have noses? We get a cute little bottom screen moment, which I don't think ever really happened, but again, artistic license. Genie prepares to fix Agrabah's problem with magic, is informed that Aladdin wanted to fix it without magic, and then he proceeds to get rid of a sandstorm with magic, because fuck it, I guess. At the clock tower, RxA talk about what it means to be inseparable. Axel says you can be inseparable even if you're apart, and I don't know, I'm calling bullshit on that, just pick a different word at that point. Roxas asks Axel what it's like to have a best friend, and Axel doesn't know because he doesn't have one. Syx can be seen around the corner weeping. Not really, but I wish. They awkwardly eat ice cream, resigning to never ever be best friends with each other.
We'll all have ice cream together.
At number 47 is the previous day, day 74, Trio. I have complex feelings about this one. It has the potential to be very long, especially if you're bad at inane trivia questions that nobody would know the answer to. Okay, so setup-wise, it's a team mission with Axel to search for Shion in Twilight Town, who apparently went out on a mission and never RTC'd. Just want to point out a moment that actually made me laugh out loud. When Roxas hears that he's going to go with Axel to search for Shion, he goes, "You mean it?" And Axel says with his smug fucking face, "No, I made it all up. Go back to bed. This is all a trick. I deceived you." And then, the mission starts. Your search takes you to the sandlot, where Hayner and Olette are talking about a moaning sound from the tunnels. Oh boy, it's that guy who takes his wife up to the hill experimenting with different locations. Investigating the underground concourse leads you to Pence, who debunks the myth of the moaning married couple. Then you go back to the Sandlot, where H&O are talking about Pence being shifty. So, you go back to the tunnel, and Pence, the true boss of the mission, makes you take a fucking quiz about the town. Not because he doesn't know the answers and is genuinely asking you, but because he's a vile little gerbil who's testing you even though a person is missing. And you're better off brute forcing it. It'll take less time than slowly exploring the town again to find some obscure shit. Just awful. Normally, I like trivia and exploration, but the game just feels like it's dicking you around here. And to top it all off, he doesn't even have any good intel in exchange, just that the rumors are bogus. But Axel does extrapolate that there's some weirdness in the woods, which leads you all the way over there as very slow DS Roxas. You have to hit a rustly tree, which is cute at least, though you're unfortunately not greeted with Little Chef, but instead the Veil Lizard, who runs off to the old mansion. Shion shows up halfway through the battle and gets absolutely tongue-thwapped. After the battle, the three truly become the titular trio when they come up with the aforementioned double-duty plan. Roxas will take on Shion's workload while she remembers how to Keyblade. Thankfully, this doesn't really have any gameplay ramifications in terms of heart collection. At this point, whenever the scene is from Axel's perspective, we now see Shion's hood down, signifying the connection they've forged. I love this moment because you really start to feel the camaraderie between the three here, but I hate it because Shion's hood made the day's message board on GameFAQs unreadable, because it was many players' first encounter with symbolism. For number 46, we've got Day 72 Change, which is that mission with Axel to Agrabah I mentioned earlier. This day also has the potential to go on for a long time. It's one of those days that I consider to be mostly carried by the story stuff. Really good bread, but the middle of the sandwich is a bit soggy. Thankfully, the day begins with one of those classic Axel and Saix convos. Intriguing, builds off of a chain of memories, and hints towards Saix's secret agenda. These were always my favorite moments as a kid, and they still hold up today even knowing where it's all headed. The mission starts off as heart collection, but then the boys have the misfortune of stumbling across Pete, who's searching for Jafar's lamp, and I can at least appreciate the continuity between 1 and 2 here. Axel, thinking the day got off to too strong of a start, decides we need to tail Pete, and this is so bad. It's just primitive even by 2009 DS standards. There's just nothing to it at all. It felt like a total waste of time. It never comes back, and it's not even like challenging or interesting. You just stand a few feet behind him as he slowly searches, inching around to keep him in your sight. I'm not trying to be dramatic, but it's pure misery, and I'm a worse person for having experienced it. Like, if this is a tutorial for stealth, then fine, I guess it gets a pass for being slow and boring, but half of the mechanics never even return. Here, you're following Pete as he makes his way from A to B. You can't be spotted by him, but you also have to stay close enough to keep him in your own cone. Later on, you get Cogsworth and Lumiere and the Card Soldiers with their own vision cones, but they're on a set looping path, and your line of sight on them is irrelevant. So, I don't know, it always just felt unfinished, but I can't say I'm upset they didn't use it more throughout the game. Also, it's funny that Axel calls Pete a lunkhead, considering that's one of Pete's insults of choice.
That's right, lunkheads! Pete's invincible!
If for all these years you thought he was saying, "That's right, kids, Pete's invincible," then please leave a comment below for engagement. At least the cave is all new, and it's the first new environmental content we get in the game besides the gray area. So oddly, it's something of a highlight for the game since so much of the worlds are recycled. I like that the cave seems to change interiors every game. This look is way more in line with KH1's design philosophy, and that's really cool. On paper, that is. In practice, I'm long on the record for enjoying platformy puzzly stuff in my KH games, but not like this. Moving these boxes and pillars around is so arduous and takes forever, even sped up. Not that I could or would do that. And God help you if you have a Keyblade equipped that makes Roxas's combo more awkward for dealing with this. This first room sucks. You see this upper part directly in front of you and some crates to push around, so you push the crates towards that ledge to reach the area. Then you get up there, see that the gate is down, and realize you have to go back down, push the crate over to the opposite side of the room to reach a lever, then push them back towards progress. It takes forever and feels more like busy work than a puzzle, not helped by how the room is laid out. After you've spent half your day moving boxes, get ready for super precise DS jumping that Axel will get in the way of by teleporting right in front of you. You know, I like this room. If this were in KH2 or even BBS, it'd be a top 10 room in that game. But I'm convinced that Axel has his own bonus gauge and he fills it by intercepting me when I'm making my way from pillar to pillar. Regardless, once you collect enough hearts, usually after bringing the clay armor to its knees with a few fires, you can RTC. At the clock tower, Roxas and Axel eat something, I can't tell what it is, and Axel makes some cryptic comments hinting at his time with Sora in Castle Oblivion. It's fairly benign in the moment, but in hindsight and through reading the secret reports, it's one of these toxic seeds of secrecy that ends up creating cracks in the trio's friendship later on. Roxas is going to be consistently left in the dark, and at this fairly early point, Axel is already way more familiar with the truth than Roxas will be for most of the game.
Your ice cream's melting.
At number 45 is day 153, Disjointed Days. This takes us to Olympus Coliseum for Heart Collection, which Saik scheduled Demix for whatever reason. It's the first real substantial Demix stuff we get in the game, and he's quick to point out that it makes no sense why he got stuck with this mission, as he's a lazy fuck who will quickly abandon us while we do all the work. Love that guy, unironically. He will at least help out with the cannon enemies outside the gates area, but he gets too sweaty to go any further. It's a fun dynamic to see Roxas essentially be the adult in the room, basically pulling teeth to get Demix to do anything productive, when usually it's someone like Azaldin or Zigbar treating Roxas like a kid and bossing him around. Of course, this mission is most famous for the World of Phil, a massive heartless battleship that Phil attaches himself to as the final boss of Days. Very frightening stuff. Roxas does a barrel minigame, as is tradition, and you can do really shitty at it and still beat the mission, so that's nice. Roxas asks Phil who he was training in there, despite Phil currently being under the assumption that Herc personally scouted Roxas, so Roxas should know who that is. Phil says he has high expectations for Roxas, as Roxas ponders the difference between expectations and orders while smelling his hand.
He got me ice cream again.
At number 44, we've got day 22, Left Behind. This mission sends you and Axel to Twilight Town to take out a Guardian, which is a bigger recolor of the Watcher. This is just a classic Axel team-up mission. It sends you weaving through the underground concourse and spits you out at the Sandlot from the mini-boss fight against the Guardian. Along the way, you come across a lot of Minute Bombs, which you can make easier to deal with by setting them on fire immediately or blocking their tackle to send them into self-destruct mode. I prefer the fire. Thankfully, the resulting explosion can damage surrounding enemies and set off chain reactions, so it's a creative and efficient way to approach the combat when these guys show up. The main sticking point for this day is the reveal that Axel has to go on a business trip. You know, to murder people. This is also the first appearance of the Winter Stick, which Roxas will only remember that he has at the most inopportune times, and somehow manages to forget to ask Axel about it for, like, several months.
I'm gonna miss this ice cream thing we do.
At number 43 is day 359, the first day. Yes, that's right, there is a 359th day, which I guess is false advertising, though it's another completely cutscene-based occasion. When including day 359, it makes 100 days that we can witness in the game, so I had to count it. Once again, it's pretty high up here for something that's relatively short and unplayable, and viewed on its own, it probably isn't making any jaws drop, but it really works as the coda for the game. It just piles on the tragedy. This game pushes Roxas through a cluster of truly heartbreaking days, and then, if you're familiar with Cage 2, because you're supposed to play that before this, to see him plopped into his street clothes in the simulated Twilight Town, knowing where it's all going, it's just brutal. I was left feeling a bit hollow afterwards, especially at a time where Roxas still hadn't been granted autonomy. Roxas was born and then immediately put to work at a shitty job as an infant, during which he got punched in the mouth, fell into a coma, and killed his friend. And then a racist put him in his computer. That is a tough fucking break. Sanctuary plays and the credits roll as you wonder what it was all for. I fought the Leech Grave for this? This emotional sadism?
Ansem the Wise loved ice cream!
Keeping with that theme, at number 42, I've got another all-cutscene day, day 276, Disorder, famous for its Snarl of Memories sequence. I'm a bit torn on this one, because on one hand, it's not wholly necessary and could probably be cut without losing much, but on the other, it's such a mindfuck. Like, that's the point, and I know it's a bit of a simplistic way of looking at it, but throwing this trippy, voiced cutscene in the middle of a string of missions does give the game a bit of momentum. If you were to rank KH cutscenes purely on a mindfuckery metric, this would have to make the top 10. Despite just being a dream sequence, it's something of a window into Xion's existential trauma. It may not have a tangible impact on the world the game is set in, but it puts into perspective how much Xion is a wrench in this tangled system of memories. We're ramping up to the unavoidable truth that she and Roxas cannot coexist, and the backdrop for all of this is a seemingly random pull from Recom, but a pull that starts with Zexion remarking, "Surely you knew this was going to happen." For the past few weeks, Xion has been uncovering the truth behind her existence bit by bit, and Riku is not far off from giving her the existential ultimatum of a lifetime. I kind of consider this the beginning of the endgame for Xion in Days. We're gonna be real light on levity moving forward as things come to a head and outside influences really start to drive a wedge between the trio. And it provides such a juxtaposition. We have this mind-melting scene of characters morphing into others. Zexion is Xion, is Roxas, is Riku, is Sora. And most of them look like they're having the migraine of the century. Not long after, we see Xion talking to the Roxas and Axel in her head about her strongest but ultimately most simple desire, which is to be with her friends. She's got this picturesque ideal of them all sitting on the beach watching the sunset and is starting to come to terms with the cruel reality that it's just not gonna happen. Interspersed with that, we got to pull back the curtain on Riku and Naminé's operations in the interim between Calm and 2, also laying out for the player in more clear terms where Shion is headed. You probably could have guessed if you played 2, but maybe this was your first. At the clock tower, Roxas and Axel decide to dedicate their time between missions and Ice Cream to look for Shion in direct contrast to Xemnas's orders. They don't consider that maybe they don't need to eat ice cream every day and could instead use that time to look for Shion as well, but who am I to rob them of the one thing they like in life? In his secret report for the day, Axel affirms to himself that nothing will change the fact that he and Shion are friends, even if she's a replica, or that nobody supposedly shouldn't feel friendship.
We'll all have ice cream together.
At number 41 is Day 26, Terminated, which has a lot going on. Most importantly, it's the first appearance of the organization Moogle with his little fucking coat. And it took me until my third playthrough to pick up on how he references Zenmet's line when he says his name is of no importance. Also in the gray area is a cavalier discussion about at least one of Roxas's co-workers dying. It's treated as gossip, and nobody but Roxas really seems to give a shit, and it's honestly kind of upsetting, even if you know what's going on at Castle Oblivion. The one guy who gave Roxas a break is gone, and Roxas is a minnow amongst sharks. Sure, there's that quiet girl, but he's known her for like 3 days. The environment and atmosphere is somehow even colder and more unforgiving despite Larxene, Vexen, and Man Who Hits Children Lexius being removed from the equation. Our mission today takes us to Agrabah for the first time, and thankfully it's KH1 Agrabah, the more interesting of the Agrabahs, but with a twist. I really like this stuff from Days, like obviously the literal building blocks are the same, the skeleton of the environment here is pulled from KH1, but there are little alterations to suggest something beyond a static world that never undergoes change. The city is littered with mounds of sand, building supplies, and scaffolding. I wish we could have had more stuff like this in the other worlds. Beast Castle has some claw marks and unkempt furniture here and there. Halloween Town is populated by those bug balloons and pumpkin bombs, but Agrabah's little edits are the most fun and noticeable. It's one of the more interesting recon missions, trying to figure out what's going on in the city, and Roxas eventually deduces that Agrabah is being ravaged by sandstorms and has to keep rebuilding. I like to think that this was to help give an excuse as to why the city looks so dramatically different in KH2. The damage was just so bad that the citizens had to redesign it completely. The bonus gauges in the recon missions are pretty fun since you're also rewarded with additional information. Filling the gauge here will cause Roxas and Zigbar to piece together that the storms are being caused by Heartless. This is some cool foreshadowing for the Antlion battle later on. Gotta say though, I remember being disappointed when Roxas suggested exploring the palace before Zigbar fittingly shoots that down. Before RTCing, Roxas asks Zigbar where Heartless go when slain. They go to Kingdom Hearts, the best game in the series. Nobodies, however, have nothing to leave behind since they're not supposed to be in the first place, and that's a chilling revelation to have as a 26-day-old. From his perspective, he has less of a post-death trajectory than those little bug guys he's been killing. Zigbar says Roxas will never see whoever died at CO again, which is a big ol' lie, but whatever. In actuality, being a nobody is like one of the best gigs you can have. It's really a way to get a second chance, assuming your Heartless is slain. Before Roxas can leave Agrabah, he passes out, kicking off that coma we've already covered. We then see Naminé drawing in the White Room. It's probably not important.
Not if you explode from all that ice cream first.
At number 40, I've got Day 73, The Promise. This one also sends us to a new world for the first time, this time being Beast Castle. I always thought it was kind of weird that Beast Castle was the one KH2 Disney World they picked for Days, since every other Disney World besides Neverland builds off of KH1's level geometry. But I figure it does make the most sense, as the organization's meddling is most felt in this world out of the other KH2 options, which we'll get to later. Before leaving, Roxas talks to Axel about Shion disappearing, her favorite thing to do, and Axel says he'll talk to Saix and see what he knows about it. It's a homie move, since Axel doesn't really even know Shion, but he knows her and Roxas are tight, and he's willing to talk to Saix, the worst man on the planet, about it. This mission sends you after a sergeant, which is just a big soldier Heartless. The day immediately gets points from me just for the little statue pushing puzzle in the courtyard. It's not exactly a brain buster, but it asks you to look around a bit and interact with the environment, and you don't have to push any of the statues across an entire football field, looking at you, Agrabah. The day's version of Beast Castle just adds some upper levels to the entrance hall and the ballroom, which aren't as engaging as the new Agrabah cave, but it's still kinda neat. Sorta weird that Sora was able to park the gummy ship in the parlor in KH2, but Roxas had to portal onto the bridge and then infiltrate the castle through the upper levels like a little rat.
Let's get some ice cream.
Heading back to the early game for number 39, it's day 8, the icing on the cake. This is the first truly playable day, though it's just basic tutorial stuff. Makes you wonder if the organization uses the underground concourse every time they have to train a new member. Like, did Axel also teach Marluxia how to jump and hang from ledges here? I guess Roxas is a special case since he's a little baby who was just born. We also learn that the organization puts up this nothingness spaghetti to mark off places they don't want members to go to. Does Xemnas physically have to go on site and rope off the areas he wants his employees to keep out of, or can he do that from his high chair? Anyway, right out of the gate, this mission serves as an example of what's lost in the movie version of the game. Axel's got such fun lines here between talking is dumb and the whole exchange about the treasure chest. Roxas is mostly communicating through Morse code at this point, but then he has this dramatic head turn at the end to shit talk how easy the mission was. It's genuinely funny. Famously, this mission also establishes icing on the cake as the central religious ceremony of the game. No mission is complete without a little icing on the cake. But don't we have to RTC? RTC stands for Reach the Cream! On that note, the game also introduces RTC to us here, which is both a stupid and entirely believable initialism. Every workplace has dumbass slang and abbreviations, and the organization is no exception. They really only have this and CO, but it does help make the group feel like it has an actual work culture of some kind.
You remember what this ice cream is called?
At number 38 is day 51, Missing. I've been at this so long, I think I'm missing some brain cells now. This is Roxas' first day back on the job after his big nap, and it sends him to Agrabah to kill fire plants. Before heading out, Roxas hears from Syax that they still don't know all the details about what happened with everyone at CO. Funnily enough though, Zigbar will actually spoil it before the Syax scene if you do his optional dialogue where he says everyone who went to CO is toast. But Roxas probably doesn't understand that this is a euphemism, and he spends the rest of the day thinking Axel is a piece of bread now. But kind of a weird thing there, I don't know if Syax is lying, dumb, or if Zigbar is just more in the know. I mostly dislike this day for introducing the Barrier Master. It's a fun gimmick that changes how you approach battles. It reminds me of the hoodoo sorcerers from Rayman 3, hopefully that hits with at least one person watching. I wish there were more occasions of Heartless interacting with each other and displaying some synergy. You have stuff like loudmouths healing their allies, but it'd be cool to have more situations that force you to play differently. Oh, Aladdin and Jasmine are here by the way, but they're boring.
I wish I had my own ice cream flavor.
Number 37 brings us to day 296, Confessions, and that's the real meat of the day, which happens at the clock tower. The mission takes place in Olympus Coliseum, the last mandatory mission here, and requires Roxas to once again enter the games to do heart collection. Honestly, I thought it was kind of weird to come back to the Coliseum. The last mandatory mission here ended on a conclusive and funny note between the guard armor battle and the Phil realization. So it's weird to come back and be like, oh, hey, you vanished last time and you're not Herc's guy that he picked. Anyway, wanna do the games again? The most noteworthy part of said games is the round with the elevated cannon enemies that you have to hit barrels at while avoiding their fire. That was kind of neat. The last opponent is a stalwart blade, which I've designated in my notes as a bullshit fucker. He's a souped-up zip slasher, and it's not necessarily that he's difficult, it just takes a long time to deal with him. Afterwards, Roxas and Axel bemoan that they haven't found Shion. Axel reveals to Roxas that Shion comes from CO, the only place Roxas hasn't checked, Colorado. Whereas the Snarl of Memories moment felt like the place where Shion's endgame began, this is where I feel like it begins for Roxas, who's now armed, finally, with a useful piece of information setting us up for the tragedies to come.
Special recipe ice cream!
For number 36, we've got Day 97 at Transfer. For the record, I have no idea why the day is called that. There's no story progression outside of Agrabah here, so I'm not sure what that refers to, but let me know if you do. Obviously, you can do this mission on a different day, you can make this your Day 100 if you want, but I don't know what happens in the surrounding days to make sense of the title. Maybe it's supposed to refer to Syax transferring Axel to a different mission and letting Roxas and Shion team up during a different day in this batch? That was my Day 96 on this file, so I don't know. Anyway, I don't mind the Antlion, it's the first boss I've covered that I feel more positive than negative about. Maybe an indictment on the game or my skills, but it's my truth. Assuming I am good at video games, I'd still probably have this guy in the lower third of a list when stacked up against the bosses in the mainline games, but for days it's got some neat stuff. We've talked about it with the lizard enemies already, but this is the first boss to make use of the bottom screen for the purposes of tracking an enemy's movement when you can't see it on the top screen. And the arena is big, so it'll come in handy if you lose sight of him. Which, by the way, it's cool that they also represented Cage 2 Agrabah here with a modified version of the Sandswept Ruins, which was sort of my de facto favorite area in that version of the world. I guess the main negative point here is that the antlion can really put some distance between you and him, and having to trot through the sand without something like glide can be a bit tedious, especially if the boss isn't actively doing an attack to keep things interesting. The antlion's moves are fairly manageable, though I think the most engaging part of the fight is when he goes all upright tornado mode and you have to knock the blocks into him. It's sort of reminiscent of golfing the presence back at Oogie in Cage 2. But god did the camera fuck me up when I was playing it for this run. In terms of integration with the story of the world, the antlion is up there with Leechgrave as one of the stronger Heartless bosses. Maybe the best, since the Leechgrave feeding on the Heartless plotline isn't really introduced immediately in Halloween Town, whereas Agrabah's sandstorm problem is established early on, and the antlion is the main cause of that. So it's a nice end to that thread. Also, look at this genie foreshadowing, this totally planned thing. Genie says three's a crowd, and he's referencing the fact that the Sea Salt Trio are doomed to be separated. He knows Roxas and Shion cannot coexist in the endgame. He's kind of omnipotent.
I'll go get some ice cream.
Number 35 is Day 149, Unlike Minds, which is our first outing to Halloween Town in the game. Roxas is sent there to do some basic heart collection throughout Guillotine Square and the graveyard. The mission itself is fine, it introduces creep worms, which are very satisfying to kill because you can just pop them in one hit. It's also the first appearance of skater bombs and hover ghosts, which you can more easily deal with by chucking the pumpkin bombs at. The mission does unfortunately start the trend of Lock, Shock, and Barrel throwing bombs at Roxas, a bit that I hardly found amusing the first time, and definitely not the next four or five fucking times. Of course, we also see Jack doping around about Halloween. I don't know why I'm so down on Jack. To be honest, I'm not really impressed with anything Halloween Town does in this game besides the idea of the Leechgrave. Everything else feels especially fillerish to me. The end of the day conversation is marked by Shion failing to show for ice cream because she's catching up on sitting in the fetal position in her room, which I completely get. We get a brief but full cutscene here of Shion being defeated by a mysterious Riku-shaped man, setting us up for Shion's next arc of inner conflict moving forward.
I'm sorry about the ice cream!
At number 34, believe it or not, we still have a few optional missions left. This is where I'm slotting in Day 302, which has no name but stood out to me nonetheless. I probably have it too high, but it served as an example of what all the optional missions could have been, so I wanted to reward it for that. The mission sends you to Halloween Town to eliminate a giant Heartless, which ends up being a Chill Ripper. Already it starts off kind of unorthodox, since Zigbar is already out in the field for whatever reason, and Roxas needs to meet up with him. Gameplay-wise, it's just a bunch of scripted mob fights, one at the square and then the hill, followed by the boss at the bridge. Partway through, you enter the graveyard, and Zigbar has like this cool little cutscene where he takes out a bunch of shadows by shooting them from the sky. Mind you, absolutely nothing progresses plot-wise, but I just loved the banter between Roxas and Zigbar, and I just wish we could have had more stuff like this. If you're gonna send me to kill an XYZ in Beast Castle with Axel on an optional day, just have them shoot the shit a bit. Or in this case, shoot the sentient ice cubes a bit.
Sea salt ice cream.
Makes sense to me to follow up with the other really good optional mission, so at number 33 is Day 322, which is actually titled The Program. This is basically just a beefed up version of the Zigbar and Halloween Town mission, since this one has a bit more meat to it as far as story is concerned, as minor as it may be. Once again, it's set up a bit differently than most missions, as the goal is to find Zaldin, who's mysteriously gone missing in Beast Castle. I've got my own theories. The mission basically plays out as a recon mission, but you're less so examining certain spots and more so just checking different parts of the map until you trigger something. You're trying to find Zaldin, so you can probably just make a beeline to the beast's room, and if that fails, wherever the beast's laundry gets washed. Okay, not actually. You go to the ballroom and see Belle worrying about how the beast is acting strange, and later on you overhear Cogsworth and Lumiere talking about seeing a man with black hair and a black coat.
Zaldin seemed awfully interested in the beast.
Sure, interested. Let's go with that. Roxas watches Beast freaking out and eventually catches up with Zaldin. It becomes evident that Zaldin has been spending a lot of time here planting seeds, and oddly enough, this is like the first glimpse Roxas gets of the organization meddling or causing harm in outside worlds. The group obviously has plenty of member-on-member violence and shady politicking, but it's at least kept to themselves. But in this case, you can tell Roxas feels uneasy about Zaldin's manipulation here, and it's kind of crazy that this immediate prologue to the Cage 2 Beast Castle story is entirely optional. I also just wanted to mention, there's a lot of excellent unintentional comedy in this part where the Blitz Spear drops in the Undercroft area, and he's like, "Yeah, look at me, I'm a bad motherfucker," and then you can just leave. I love that.
He got me ice cream again.
Rewinding back to the early times, number 32 brings us Day 25, Two Keys. This is our first real Roxas and Shion mission of any substance, and sends us to Twilight Town to take down a Darkseid, the first true boss of the game. Right off the bat, Shion reveals her face to Roxas, which, if I may be so bold, is a moment I do think plays better in the movie version, not that it's bad here. We then see that Xemnas has put up spaghetti in front of the usual spot.
The heart collection quota is not being met, and an internal affairs investigation has revealed that you've all been goofing off, playing darts, so you've left me no choice.
The dark side battle is nothing remarkable, but it's solid. It's definitely a little less intimidating than its KH1 appearances, if only because it seems kinda small when next to the clock tower. And by this point, it's the fifth time you fought this thing if you're playing the games in release order. It's the same old tricks as usual, though this dark side adds a big shockwave when it slams its fist, which you've gotta jump over, so I like that. The battle is followed by a sick cutscene where Shion just cuts right through the big bastard using Roxas's Keyblade after he drops it. The duo then discovers that Shion can use it too, instead of exclusively casting fire and or getting hit. But the highlight of the day is Roxas continuing the chain of ice cream, initiating Shion with the same icing on the cake routine that Axel did with him. It's very sweet, and the two vow to have ice cream together when Axel gets back from his murdercation. So many hours of brain freeze and playful shoving atop a tall structure await them.
We'll all have ice cream together.
For number 31, I've got day 150, Fear. This day follows the one that ended with Shion recalling her run-in with Riku, and opens with more clips from that encounter, featuring Riku being the embodiment of 2009 atop a castle roof. On the way to clock in for the day, Roxas overhears a conversation with Shion and Saix, who surprisingly just sees her with her hood up and not as an actual walking, talking piece of trash. Shion asks Saix for another chance, but Saix says no and leaves to go look at the moon. At this point, we don't really know what Shion's deal is, so this all injects a bit of intrigue into the day-to-day grind. The mission is with Zaldin to Beast Castle, and Zaldin told me not to drag my heals, but I dragged every heal I had here, several cures and a couple of high potions. Along the way to the target, you'll also fight a Giga Shadow in the ballroom as like a mini-boss type thing. But the main goal here is to take out the Dark Follower, which I think is literally a purple palette swap of Darkseid with higher stats and no other meaningful changes. If anything, it's kind of funky to see one of these guys in an indoor location. He, really brings the room together. After the battle, Zaldin is ready to RTC, but then they hear the Beast roar, and suddenly he wants to stay and check things out, confirming that he has a crush on the Beast. They go spy on his temper tantrum, and Zaldin pieces together that the rose is tied to the Beast's beasthood. Probably could have picked a better word than beasthood, but I'm keeping it. I do appreciate the attempts to flesh out Zaldin's obsession with the Beast, since that's like his whole shtick in Cage 2. I mean, it's his whole shtick here as well, but at least we get more time to see it develop here. Afterwards, Roxas and Axel chat at the clock tower.
Too bad I don't remember my past. What about your present? You got me a gift?
This is a great conversation. It really gets to the heart of the no hearts thing. Anybody flipping shit after the dream drop reveal about nobody's being able to grow hearts needs to have their eyelids taped open and be made to watch this scene. They beat you over the head with how Roxas clearly feels a sense of fear over potentially losing his friends. Axel, having been conditioned by Xemnas and the organization for way longer, tries to convince him that it's all in his head, that Roxas is just remembering what fear feels like, even though Roxas has no real memories of his time before the organization. At least none that occur to him without static. The scene ends with Roxas feeling unsure and looking unconvinced. It's such a solid moment.
Having ice cream.
I'll get out ahead of this and say, I know that this is low. For number Earth, I'm going with day 255, the longest day, and they fucking meant it when they said that shit. This is like the mixed bag day for me. You're gonna see days that are by and large much less extraordinary than this one above day 255 on my list, because despite being home to the sun setting red and some good story content, it's dragged down by what I found to be a very slow and annoying mission. The day starts with a scene in the round room, moments which are just second to any time we get Axel and Saix chatting. It's a meeting of the top dogs, only Xemnas, Zigbar, and Saix were CC'd on the meeting invite, and Saix reveals that he's sent Axel to CO to fetch Shion, who they know access to their computer system. Zigbar is being a shady bitch, and Xemnas remains completely unfazed by all of this.
The only steps we need take are two. Watch and wait. AKA, nothing.
The scene switches over to Castle Oblivion, where we see Shion run into Axel, who tries his best to convince Shion that she's got nothing to do with this place, but Shion remains steadfast in her search for the truth. She has an unexplained love for isometric rooms and card-based combat, and damn it, she needs to know why. The mission sends Roxas and Luxord to Wonderland, and even he seems sick of this place, for good reason. The goal is to kill the Nova Shadow, but to make it appear, you need to flick four switches to turn lamps on in the bazaar room. How do you do that? By slowly fucking making your way past the cards in the hedge maze. It's atrocious. If you're spotted, you get sent back. My notes refer to this as ass on ass, like a towering ass sandwich. I don't mind when the game is hard. This is not bad. It's boring. I hate waiting. I don't care if it's shallow. That's how I feel. And once you're done, the Cheshire Cat acts like he's doing you a favor by giving you a hint as to where you need to go next, even though you clearly see the lamps turning on in the bazaar room each time you flick a switch. Fuck you, cat. The Nova Shadow is at least kinda cool, though Luxord and I just sorta melted it before it could do much of anything. The day caps off with the cutscene from the beginning of the game, which is legitimately charming, but also highlights the comfortable facade that Axel's putting up, since he knows the truth about Xion's location, unbeknownst to Roxas. Once again, the tone here is a bit different in the game versus the movie, as the latter doesn't adapt the text parts of this cutscene from the game. Here, Axel basically actively comes up with a lie instead of staying silent, which I think definitely complicates his character. We end on Xion in Castle Oblivion, pondering her orb.
Should've brought some ice cream.
Taking things over to a different castle, it's number 29 and day 171, Love. This sends Roxas to Beast Castle for his final required mission there with the goal of taking out a giant Heartless. This ends up being the Infernal Engine, who makes a hell of a first impression by fucking a yeeting beast over the impossibly high castle gate. This boss gave me a lot of grief when I streamed the game, but taking a step back from it, I think it's one of my preferred ones in the game. Again, I don't love it in spite of the day name, but it's nowhere near Leechgrave or even Ruler of the Sky territory. It's got a lot of creative and varied attacks, and like most day's bosses, requires a bit of patience, which is naturally my least favorite part. It can be a bit slow while you're waiting for the thing to stop shooting its cannons for what feels like an eternity, but besides that, it's a decent challenge learning how to deal with its different moves. The worst part is probably any time where you're backed up against the wall and it's hard to tell what's going on thanks to the camera, but it doesn't sink the fight. Afterwards, Roxas watches Beast and Belle share a nice moment, and it seems like all is well until you remember everything gets mucked up if you play an optional mission or KH2. As Roxas reflects on their relationship, Zaldan appears from out of nowhere.
Zaldan, when did you get here?
That's my secret, I'm always here.
Zaldan denounces love, especially the kind felt by beasts, and Roxas, get fucking this, asks what love is. He knew what a candelabra was on sight, but not love. I do want to bring attention to possibly the best Zaldan character reading I've ever seen, which says a lot considering I've never held him in super high regard. This comes from longtime Twitch viewer and patron Romsom, who actually suggested this video as an offhand comment and I took it too seriously. It reads, and I quote, "Zaldan's whole shtick is that he became a nobody in order to avoid emotions, presumably some sort of heartbreak. Unlike the rest of the organization who talk about how much they want a heart, Zaldan actively dismisses having a heart. He hates the concept of love because he was unable to experience it. When he sees a literal beast, a creepy buffalo monster, experiencing love, the thing that he is unable to experience, it bothers him and he becomes obsessed with trying to ruin it." End quote. I honestly love that. Like, you have to read between the lines a bit when Zaldan scoffs at love and how it's useless, but this reading does add some dimension to him, and it makes this whole beast saga make a lot more sense. Anyway, Zaldan avoids the question, forcing Roxas to ask man who has definitely never been on a date, Axel.
Axel, do you think love can bloom even on a battlefield?
This is a really fun conversation, though, if only because it's amusing watching Axel trying to navigate it. It's like the closest thing you'll see to a birds and bees conversation in Kingdom Hearts. Axel's like, well, it's like there's friends, there's best friends, but then there's love, but there's not steps. I mean, it's like friends, but it's not. Anyway, stop asking questions. Roxas wonders if he'd be able to love if he had a heart. Unrelated, last month I ranked all the different Kingdom Hearts ships, if you want to check that out.
Double Crunch Ice Cream!
And back on over to the early game for number 28, which is day 14, Friends. I guess Friends is actually a step up from love in this case. This day takes place after the slew of missions with the Chain of Memories members, and the game basically tells you, tutorial is over now. Axel says that this is the first really real mission, implying that getting assaulted by Lexius or berated by Larxene wasn't more difficult than whatever we're doing today. The mission itself is super simple, you're just doing heart collection with Axel in Twilight Town with a few forced mob fights thrown in. Pro tip, later on in the game, when Zigbar wants you to get a bunch of kills with your limit, go let yourself get mobbed by the possessors here and rack up the kills at this spot. And then you can get some more on the next screen, withdraw, and repeat till you're done. This mission will likely be your first run-in with annoying backpack syndrome. I get the backpack system, but I feel like I still have license to roll my eyes when I can't open a chest with a potion in it, and I want to check off all the treasures for that given day, so I use a potion on a full HP Roxas so I can pick up the new potion. Despite the low mission stakes, I think this day deserves to be this high up, since it's Roxas's first look at life outside the organization and friendship as presented by Haner, Pence, and Olette. In that order, and no other order. This plants the seed for a long-standing yearning that Roxas feels, because these are the first heart-having people he comes across, and everyone back home is telling him how important and rad it is to have a heart. These guys laugh at stupid shit, that's what people with hearts do. Obviously, we see RXA do that all the time in the name of friendship, which leads us to a bunch of moments of confusion and doubt where Roxas and Xion question the nature of being a nobody. Roxas's understanding of what friends and people with hearts are in this scene run in complete contrast with what the rest of the organization says and how he's being conditioned to understand his non-existence. And it's equal parts funny and sad to see Roxas essentially give laughing a test run later on at the clock tower to affirm to himself that he and Axel really are friends.
How about a sea salt ice cream then?
Coming in at number 27 is Day 95, Nobodies, sort of a natural follow-up to the last entry, especially when we get to the Clock Tower conversation. Before that, it's very much a going-through-the-motions day, with Roxas and Shion doing heart collection in Agrabah, and no real surprises or developments while you're there. All there really is a land armor being guarded by one of those book guys. The routineness of it all is even reflected by the characters. They're like, yeah, same shit, different day. I think this is one of the best conversations in the game. Like, they're not just talking about how their friends are eating ice cream, there's like an actual flow to this conversation, with both joking and serious moments. They start off talking about the daily grind, and then it transitions into worrying about how long Roxas and Shion can keep up the double duty charade. Then they rag on Demix for a while, and it just feels believable to me, like, of course they would shit-talk their co-workers a bit. Mostly Roxas, Axel actually tries to defend him a little, though he sort of gives up. They talk about how everyone in the organization is unique, though Shion asks if people need hearts to be unique. Axel says there are other things to set nobodies apart, like their past, or their stupid fucking hair. They then reach the conclusion that Roxas and Shion are especially uniquely unique, since they don't remember their past, which also makes them similar, diluting the uniqueness a bit. Roxas wonders what guy he used to be, and Axel has literally met that guy, so there's even a bit of dramatic irony injected into this scene. Just an overall really fun, funny, and meaningful scene, if you ask me.
Didn't he sell ice cream?
For number 26, we have Day 174, Action Reaction. This is Roxas' first visit to Neverland, which I feel like is a bit of a polarizing world in Days. It's the only world to be more new than old, but the new is, you know, rocks in the ocean. Well, scratch that, the new is also two frankly great music tracks composed specifically for Days, which are my personal highlight of the world. Maybe that's not saying much, since its most obvious competition is, like, Ruler of the Sky and Ocean Rocks, but I don't know, I think there's some fun stuff here. For this mission, Roxas is sent here alone to track down the Wavecrest, which sounds like some sort of tubular jet ski brand from the 90s. He notices Smee and Hook digging for treasure, and Hook looks rough. There's a sort of running joke that whenever they manage to dig up a chest, a Heartless pops out, but it's really just Hook's greed they're attracted to, so that's kind of fun. It's all being set up by Pete in what's probably his smartest plan to date, so good for him. Tink shows up and looks really excited to see Roxas, and while the game is using bottom screen Sora moments that might suggest that he just reminds her of Sora, I like to think it's because she remembers Ven and thinks that that's him. Sure, Phil met both of them and didn't seem to draw a connection, but he's also sorta dumb, like he can't count single-digit numbers. And maybe Ven was just here like a few days ago in Neverland time. We get an especially fun bottom screen moment when Roxas gets sprinkled with pixie dust and starts flying, harkening back to the moment Sora first flew in KH1. Minor nitpick, Roxas should have just gotten to the cliff edge and then Tink shows up from the other side so that he also does a backwards jump, but whatever. Tink clearly wants Roxas to follow her, but Roxas is gonna take like 3 or 4 missions to ignore her, instead focusing on the mission, which is slowly checking a bunch of holes until the Wavecrest shows up for a mid-air battle that is, coincidentally, fairly mid. Neverland itself is obviously pretty bare bones here. I think we can all agree that the BBS version is environmentally the most interesting, but most of our Neverland missions are focused on flying combat, so it's not like they needed anything beyond a bunch of open space to make those happen. After the mission, Roxas talks about flying with Axel, who doesn't seem to believe him. Then Roxas says it felt familiar, and Axel goes silent, so I wonder if he's like, ah shit, yeah, Sora probably flew, I could see that.
An ice cream flavor just for you!
Coming in at number 25, it's Day 119, Work to Do, and I don't really want to do the work today, but do it we must. We're in the home stretch here. This is a mission to Beast Castle with Zaldan that begins fleshing out his obsession with the Beast, though to be honest, it already seemed fairly established by the time you get here, as he's already explored the place off-screen by himself. As for the gameplay, it's a basic recon mission throughout the castle. You gotta dodge the clock and candle walking around, you need to kill enemies without running into the former and sneak past the ladder. Roxas thinks Belle is pretty, Zaldan's like, I've got my eyes on someone else. And eventually they find the rose. Zaldan figures that the Beast is protecting it and deems this a weakness. But also, if Zaldan can just teleport to the rose, what the fuck are we doing dodging Lumiere? Which, again, is easy if you have 2 brain cells to rub together, but impossible if you're streaming it as regular Pat. Back at the Clock Tower, Roxas and Shion meet up alone since Axel is still on his secret mission. Once again, I just like their conversation here where they try to figure out why caring about something or someone could be considered a weakness. The series has obviously preached about friends being a source of power, and even though Zaldan is being a bit of a doomer about it, having someone you really care about, someone you can't bear to lose, can be used against you. And we're gonna see that hit all 3 of our protagonists in the face as we get down to the endgame.
Who else will I have ice cream with?
Number 24 takes us back to Neverland for Day 195, which is nameless. You know, like the star. This one has Axel tagging along with Roxas to kill 3 artful flyers, and I just think it's really fun to see Axel convince himself that he can fly and realize that Roxas wasn't being a bullshitter. Every time they close their eyes and do the little head tilt tippy toes thing is hilarious. Tinkerbell shows up and she's pissed, and she's gonna continue to be because Roxas is only friends with you if you give him ice cream, otherwise he ain't doing shit for you. Okay, that's not true, but he really drags his heels on it. She really wants Roxas to check out the ship. Unrelated, last month I ranked all the different Kingdom Hearts ships if you want to check that out. You're doing more digging through holes here, but with the added spice of Hook and Smee taking pot shots at you with the elongated Thomas, I made the mistake of walking away from the game without pausing and came back to a dead Roxas. At the clock tower, Roxas and Axel hype up the magical dust that can make you fly to Shion. Joke about drugs goes here. It's nice to see them have something pleasant to talk about since we'll be running out of those moments soon. Even now, the energy here is off, but Axel and Shion both independently decide to say nothing about it to Roxas.
Royal Berry Ice Cream!
For number 23, it's day 172, Sound of the Surf. The day's got a great start. It kicks off with Roxas finally telling off Saix, who informs them that Shion has fallen into a coma after her last mission. Obviously, the big Saix catharsis moment comes later, but this is at least some red meat in the meantime. It's seriously satisfying to see Roxas give him some attitude and literally ask, "What is wrong with you?" Roxas goes to visit Shion, who's kind of stepping on his bit with the whole being in a coma thing. He goes, "Oh good, I've been looking for an excuse to get rid of all these," and puts a seashell near her pillow. For the mission, it's our first time teamed up with Luxord to go to Wonderland. Outside of two optional missions, this is the only place Luxord gets to go. I guess they send him to the place with a bunch of cards just to fuck with them. Also, like, every single thing he says for the first stretch of being around him is a gambling phrase, so get used to that. Their targets are a bunch of pink concertos, who I guess have the element of poison. I don't know, they're very easily killable as long as you have some fires, because they do have a titload of HP. The gimmick of this mission is that you need to kill the Heartless near the flowers so you can examine them, upon which they release the concertos, so points for that minor shakeup, I guess. The Cheshire Cat gives his first and last useful hint for the final concerto, telling you it's in a birdcage. I actually like this one, since it expects you to remember where you may have seen one of those. It's not like Pence's bullshit. He'd be like, "How many hedges are in the hedge maze? I'm Pence, fuck you." He's always saying that. Luxord says Roxas is dumber than a cat, and they RTC. Once again, the clock tower scene for this day really hammers home the idea that Roxas definitely feels emotions, since Axel is like, "Man, I swear sometimes it seems like you really are heartbroken. It's almost as if..." Nah, let's believe Xemnas. Roxas says, "I don't know how real people talk, and I've never identified with anything more than that." Axel says he'll try to fish some info out of Saix about what's wrong with Shion and why he's such a bastard man. We immediately get a scene afterwards where they yell at each other. It's been a really tough divorce for them. I think all of this hits even harder with me after KH3 when Saix explains how shut out he felt when Roxas and Shion came into the picture. Even before that though, you have enough information, some insinuated and some outright given to you, to recognize that Axel and Saix have a complicated past and present.
Ice cream?
At number 22 is day 194, like it should be. That's the name of the day, not a declarative statement from me. You can put this day wherever you want in your own very, very long ranking video of every day's day. Once again, we're headed back to Wonderland for the last time on this list, minus a cutscene. This one has Roxas and Luxord hunting down three commanders, who the Queen of Hearts and the Card Soldiers are also trying to capture. While I truly loathed the card stealth parts in The Longest Day, they're not so bad here, probably because this happens before that, so they're easing you into the pure unbearability that you'll be mired in later. You're never forced to slowly walk behind a card, instead you just have to wait and run at the opportune moment, so this is way more tolerable. And this is the first mission with the hedge mazes, which isn't much, but we take what we can get when it comes to new environments and days. After defeating the three commanders, Roxas and Luxord overhear the Queen threatening the cards with death if they don't find their targets. And we just killed those targets, and the Queen doesn't know that, so, rip, I guess. Luxord's like, "Haha, oops, oh well," but he's a saint for creating the RTC portal in the middle of the maze instead of making us walk all the way back. Luxord also comments throughout the mission that curiosity can help you carve a path through life, but it can also lead to misfortune. Fittingly, we then see a scene of Axel in the castle library reading a report written by Vexen titled "The Truth About Naminé." Curiosity indeed. At this point, as evidenced by his secret report for this day, Axel now fully understands that Shion is a replica, and this will weigh heavy on him for the rest of the game. This is followed by a scene of Shion expressing how thankful she is to have Roxas and Axel around. And yeah, I mean, imagine how brutal it would be for her without the two of them. She's treated like an inanimate object anyway, and these two are like her only solace.
It's just the ice cream machine!
At number 21, we have day 152, The Wrong Buttons. Admittedly, I like this one for the gameplay shakeup more than anything that happens story-wise. Because honestly, when you're playing like 93 different missions, a lot of them blur together, so anything that sticks out in my memory as out of the ordinary is gonna do well so long as it's not actively infuriating. This mission sends Roxas to Halloween Town for heart collection. When he arrives, he notices that the Heartless seem less abundant, which is setting us up for the Leech Grave reveal later. I guess the implication is that the Heartless have to hide now to avoid being eaten, so that's pretty cool. The whole thing is built around the gimmick of collecting bones to give to Zero, who leads Roxas to different Heartless hiding spots. It's cute in concept, albeit a bit slow, and it's sort of awkward how you need to examine things while jumping in the air sometimes. I don't think the series ever has you do that again at any other point. Oh, Lockshock and Beryl show up again to prank you with another facial injury. They should really start a YouTube channel. They're just so funny. Today's Clock Tower conversation is a doozy. Axel's like, "Women, am I right? And nobody women? Don't get me started." I wonder if Lee had like a tight five that he did at shitty clubs in Radiant Garden. Axel warns Roxas that he needs to avoid pressing the wrong buttons, and I assume he's referring to every time I try to dodge roll in the gray area and end up opening the fucking menu. That aside, it's still a fun sort of older brother advice type of moment between Axel and Roxas. I wonder if he's really speaking from any experience or if he's just watched Larxene eviscerate Demix from a distance.
Meet up there for ice cream.
Coming in at number 20 is day 173, Lies. Before setting out on the mission, Axel tells Roxas that he talked to Saix, as this day follows the day where he promised to ask him about Shion. He says he couldn't get any info out of him, but Saix apparently said he'd stop calling her broken if she proves herself on missions. Roxas thanks Axel for trying, and Axel apologizes to him quietly after Roxas leaves. A lot of the best tension-building moments in the game involve some sort of focus on Axel where he makes an aside or holds his tongue, and this is another example of that. The mission is structurally the same as the one we just covered, with Roxas doing heart collection through the Zero Bone mechanic once again. This time the spots here are thankfully less awkward to interact with. What's kind of silly though is that you can pick up one of the bones very early in the mission but can't give it to Zero for quite a while, so it's likely that your Roxas will be just thinking about a dog bone for the majority of the mission. That stuff is all fine and good and an improvement on the previous day, but there's some other fun stuff in between. Upon reaching the graveyard, Roxas sees Jack talking to Zero about setting up lanterns for his big entrance. Roxas needs to hit some bombs at the lanterns to light them up to progress. If you've been around the channel for a while, you know I'm a complete slut for interacting with the environment to progress in KH games, as menial and simple as it may be, so this is great. Eventually, Roxas reaches the hill, whereupon he is pranked for thankfully the final time on this list, and the boy just loses it. He snaps, he beats the shit out of the trio, and this is honestly a better boss fight than the KH1 version, because you actually have room to breathe. I'll say it again, DayZ did this better than KH1. The dirty little shitheads explain that getting third-degree burns is just a prank, bro, that getting in Roxas's way is fun. Roxas doesn't get it, and neither do I. They blow a hole in the wall to escape, and you're too big to fit through at first, but you can knock a bomb into it to make the hole bigger and create a shortcut, which I absolutely love. On my way out, I had filled the bonus gauge, but I guess I had an extra leftover bone, which greatly confused Zero.
Your ice cream's melting.
At number 19 is day 321, Waning Power. At this point, we're really on the runway to the endgame and in the midst of the Sea Salt Trio breakdown. The mission here is one of the last times things feel even slightly okay, and really only between Roxas and Shion since Axel is kind of on the outs at this point. And even still, Roxas is currently going through it. There's a really cool mechanic on this day, and this day only, where Roxas is feeling off, so his level is halved. I figure they probably could have justified using this more often, since you could reasonably believe that Roxas feels off for quite a few days. I think it's a pretty cool instance of story and gameplay integration. Sometimes you just wake up for school or work, and there's nothing explicitly wrong, you just feel icky, and the whole day is kind of shot for it. But if you find this annoying, that's alright, because you don't actually have to do any fighting up until you reach your target, the spiked crawler who's in the lamp chamber. On the way to that, you actually get access to another new room in the cave, which is cool to see so late in the game. You get to do some simple platform puzzle stuff, which is nowhere near as slow and obtuse as the earlier parts of the cave. When Roxas and Shion enter the lamp chamber, Shion remembers Sora sealing the keyhole and nearly collapses, saying to Roxas, "You look so much like him, but more like jagged and handheld." Before Roxas can take offense, the spiked crawler shows up, and you can try your best to fight it, or at least I think. You're not supposed to kill this thing, the battle just ends at a point, and I'm assuming it just runs on a timer because I got no damage off on it before the cutscene kicked in. In said cutscene, Shion kills the crawler awesomely, wish he could show up like that during gameplay moments that aren't against me, but I digress. The game then cruelly makes you walk all the way back to the RTC portal. Roxas and Shion chat on the clock tower, and Roxas is upset with Axel. Shion's like, "Did you have a fight?" And Roxas is like, yeah, I mean, over the whole karate chopping you in the neck thing, ring any bells? Shion's like, "Well, he had a great reason to do it." And then we get like the most brutal Axel moment in the game. He's honestly rougher with her here than the karate chop, just a total dick. He just openly lays out all the facts with her and adds a bit of douchebag seasoning to it. I was really taken aback by it when I played it recently. How could this double homicide committer say these rude things? And then he's like, "Anyway, we're best friends, keep that in your memory banks," or something like that, I think that's the catchphrase. And then we see Lushu off to the side being Lushu-y.
"We meet here for ice cream after work."
Winding back the clock to what I consider the last early day left on the list, at number 18 is Day 71, Reunion. At this point, we're a few weeks out from half the organization being sent off to Castle Oblivion. In the morning, Lushu remarks that he doesn't mind having a smaller group, and then the Master of Masters walks in and says, "Oh yeah, those are the days, just the seven of us. Kind of like now, if you don't count the Replica Girl." I'm entirely kidding, for the record, I don't endorse any of this. No, he actually says that everyone at CO was KO'd, good job, Demix. Kinda weird that this is being presented as new information when Zygbar said 20 days ago that everyone was toast. As Roxas stands there silently mourning the loss of his first friend, Demix bemoans that he'll have to underachieve twice as hard from now on, which is a top-shelf Demix line. The actual mission is just a Shadow Glob removal at Twilight Town, the first of its kind, so at this point there's some novelty to it, and it's some of the better placements for the globs when compared to other missions. You have to do some platforming or use magic to reach a handful of them, which is preferred to just walking up to each one and smacking it. But the day is this high up because it's Axel's welcome back day, which comes as a huge relief to Roxas and probably the player. Axel reveals that only the weaklings at CO were killed, leaving out that he killed two of them. Axel briefly breaks free of his conditioning and mentions that he wanted to come here to sort out his feelings before RTCing, which Roxas calls him out on. And they just kind of laugh it off, but doesn't Roxas have a point? There's also a sort of noticeable game and movie difference here when Roxas reveals that he started inviting Shion to have ice cream. Game Axel looks like offended or put off and says, "Shion, really?" Whereas the movie doesn't show Axel's face at that part and he just says, "Shion," as if to make sure he was hearing him correctly. The game version almost paints him as seeming jealous that he was replaced, which doesn't really come through in the movie if it was ever supposed to. Just thought that was interesting.
The three of us could have ice cream when you got back.
At number 17 is Day 117, Secrets. And you know what I call this day in my notes? I called it a pretty good day, TBH. And it really is. Good scenes and the gameplay isn't frustrating or stretched out, felt perfectly paced. It kicks off with Sykes kicking down Axel's door to initiate another awesome cutscene. This one really gets into the weeds of some behind-the-scenes stuff between Xemnas' interest in Castle Oblivion and the origins of Shion, which Axel learns about here for the first time.
"Naminé isn't the only one from Castle Oblivion. Shion comes from there too."
"Oh, I thought she was from Ohio."
On top of that, it hints more at Axel and Sykes' own ulterior motives. In addition to providing the intrigue, the conversation also provides the funny between Axel saying, "Get out of my room, man," and this sassy hand he gives Sykes. Axel is told he's getting sent off to CO again, and he ponders the connection shared by Naminé, Shion, and Castle Oblivion. The secrets between the trio are starting to amass here. After a conversation in which Zygbar misidentifies Roxas as a large cat, the two head to Olympus Coliseum for the first time to do recon. Obviously, this is made pretty simple by the world retaining the same three rooms as it had in KH1, so it's not one of the more explorative recon missions. You get a mob fight with Zygbar in the gates area before he leaves to avoid detection from Phil, who takes Roxas under his wing as a new trainee. Side note, it's fun in retrospect that Zygbar ends up showing up in Olympus in KH3, since this is the Disney world he's most associated with in this game. Maybe he built up an affinity for it during these missions. After doing recon and discovering that Hercules winning the Hercules Cup is apparently canon, Roxas participates in a classic Phil Barrel game, which is probably the low point of the day, but not bad by any means. I guess Roxas playing with the barrels pushed him into overtime as he's running late to ice cream with Axel and Shion. This is actually the first scene we get of just these two, and it's not something we see often. There's only three others, and each one of those has Axel being either verbally or physically combative, so this is a rare sight. Shion talks about how she seems to have memories or something adjacent to them. This pairs nicely with the hint that Sykes fed Axel earlier in the day, and we can see Axel grappling with the information as the day ends. It's further complicated by the fact that according to one of his secret reports from a few weeks ago, Axel saw Shion's face as Naminé's, which is probably why he's wearing his "I just smell the fart" face for most of this conversation.
I'll go get some ice cream.
For number 16, I have Day 94, Hearts. This day has two fairly understated moments that tie together pretty neatly. The day kicks off with a scene at the Altar of Nod, where Xemnas moons the rest of the members. That is, he shows them the big heart moon. I forget what it's called. It's nice that Roxas gets to see that his hard work is actually amounting to something. Kinda makes you feel bad that a racist old guy is gonna blow it up in a few months. The mission sends Roxas and Shion to Beast Castle to take out a Neo Shadow. Kind of a weird target for the day, considering these things don't release hearts and we just had a whole ceremony over how cool it is that we'd collected a bunch of hearts. Roxas and Shion overhear Lumiere, and Roxas muses, "The candelabra doesn't want to be a candelabra?" I mean, yeah, Roxas, who the fuck would look at themselves as a candelabra and say, "This is fine, I like this." You gotta sneak past Lumiere and make your way to the secret passage, where the Neo Shadow shows up and dies incredibly quickly. Then two more show up and Beast fucking combos them, it's sick. Making up for his candelabra moment, Roxas astutely observes that Beast, as a master and leader, fights to protect the castle despite having servants. But Xemnas is effectively their master and just sits in his high chair all day and moons us. Shion's like, "Well, I don't know if we're servants, we're just unpaid employees with no choice in what we do and nowhere else to go. So, you know, probably something worse than servants." Roxas fails to fully wrap his head around the logical conclusion. He more so thinks it's weird that the beast has to do any fighting as someone who has servants. It's a great choice to have this convo on the same day that Xemnas shows off KH, since it undercuts Xemnas as a leader and highlights that he's nothing without his peons, whereas Beast has a two-way street of respect and teamwork with his servants, at least at this point prior to Zaldan gaslighting. It does get Roxas' gears turning further, though, as he questions at the clock tower what exactly they're trying to do with their work. Axel lays out the what of it, but Roxas can't completely get on board with the why. Axel manages to convince him that the whole point of their work is to understand the why, which satisfies Roxas for now, but his skepticism will crop up again at a later date.
Get the ice cream later!
And at number 15, we find the skepticism cropping up again at a later date and leading Roxas to a logical conclusion on day 354, Truth. The day opens with a cutscene in the round room with everyone but Shion in attendance.
Shion has vanished again.
Maybe she's at Beast Castle. I can go check if you like.
This is actually the point where most of the members learn about Shion's true nature. Xemnas, Zigbar, Syx, and Axel all know the truth already, but the others are hearing it for the first time, seemingly unfazed by being left in the dark on this. Well, Luxor does have a little comment about it as he's leaving. You'd think maybe they'd get together and talk about how it's kinda unfair that they're not kept in the loop on stuff like this, but it's possible they do get good benefits, so they're not willing to rock the boat. After revealing the truth, Xemnas assigns Axel to retrieve Shion since she escaped under his watch.
Axel, you have your orders.
Man, my hand smells ridiculous today!
Before he can leave, Roxas makes a request for Axel to not be so karate choppy with Shion this time, but he can't make any promises. Roxas then asks how long Axel's known the truth about Shion, and his answer is, bye. The mission sends Roxas to Agrabah to place a mysterious device, and what a great task to give him on a day where he realizes how truly little information he's given. The thing he's carrying and protecting is effectively going to be used as part of a plan to have him killed and assimilated into Shion, and he's none the wiser. He goes to the lamp chamber, fights a land armor, and places the device, and then realizes,
literally, what the fuck am I even doing? None of this matters. It's bullshit. This whole thing is bullshit. It's a scam. Fuck the organization. Here's 354 reasons why.
Roxas has this moment of clarity where he recognizes that he's a cog in Xemnas' capitalist machine, and this is the part where someone comments, Pat, how could you criticize capitalism if you run ads on your videos? Well, I can still play Days and wish certain things about it were done better, right? This is not one of those things, though. I love this whole sequence. Roxas walks outside, looks up at the 90s bowling alley carpet in the sky, and sheds a single tear, crushed under the weight of the knowledge that his entire young life has been controlled and built on a foundation of lies. The scene changes to the Twilight Town woods, where we see Mickey and Riku as the latter gears up to participate in the KH1 secret ending.
You're the only one who can guide Sora, Donald, and Goofy when they awaken.
Oh, don't say that, Riku. Please don't stick me with them.
You have to be there for our friends.
Well, let the record show, you said friends, not me. Huh. Two of them are employees. I hardly even know the third guy. What's his name? Soras?
Such delicious ice cream.
At number 14 is day 151, Distress. Fittingly, number 14 is a big Shion day. The day starts pretty normally. Roxas gets sent to Twilight Town to kill the Avalanche. I guess he moonlights for Shinra, too. Before he gets to it, he notices Shion on the clock tower, as she was also sent here for a mission. Shion reveals that she was being tasked with taking out the organization imposter, but failed when she was voted out and sent flying through the airlock. To cheer her up, Roxas suggests teaming up for a mission.
Hey Shion, why don't we work together today?
How?
It's easy, like this.
Apparently, Shion was put on emblem collecting duty, which seems like a fitting punishment. I just found this mission memorable for joining up with Shion and tackling two missions at once, even if one of the goals is a bit less exciting. After collecting the emblems throughout the tunnels, you encounter the Avalanche in the Sandlot, which is a pretty cool-looking ice wyvern guy. Unfortunately for him, the only thing I know in this game is the fire spell. At the clock tower, Shion is plagued by thoughts of her encounter with Riku, who tells her that she should ditch the organization. We then get the famous Shion scream, which was the Kingdom Hearts scream before Sora came along and stole the title 10 years later. This anguished cry might be the result of frustration or the most natural response to Riku's I'm the biggest nobody of them all line. It's not his best work. Shion begins to echo those feelings of doubt that Roxas first expressed after that Beast Castle mission with the Neo Shadow, though of course Roxas isn't really on that same page at this point. She leaves and we end on a scene of Sora in the Castle Oblivion field. I don't know why we're seeing that right now, but sure.
Once you finish your ice cream...
Speaking of days that stick out for being memorable, in the coveted number 13 spot is day 118, Lazy Day. It's vacation, and Roxas has no idea what that means. By the way, there's no way this vacation was planned or given out of the kindness of anyone's no heart, right? I'm guessing Sykes woke up with terrible diarrhea and just had to call the day off. Roxas, who has literally only ever lived to work, goes around trying to figure out what to do. Axel has no interest beyond sleeping, I guess he doesn't care about Frisbee anymore, so he's out. Shion decides she's gonna train with the Keyblade and invites Roxas, and this motherfucker says no, as if he has literally anything better to do, or anything else to do, period. Well, he comes up with one thing, his guiding light, the popsicle that was promised, ice cream. On his way to the only thing that gives him meaning, he runs into HBO, who are playing with the ball, as people with hearts do. Pence has the audacity to approach me after ruining my life with his quiz. They convince Roxas to try out the Grandstander minigame, which is basically the same thing from the Cage 2 prologue. I got a question for you. How the fuck do HBO not remember Roxas after this? They met the shit out of this guy. Especially considering I crushed the Grandstander record, like you should remember that even a year later. Small gripe aside, I can't help but have a soft spot for the one day Roxas gets to spend as a free bird, and one of the very few times he has exposure to friendly people outside the organization. These guys are the only example of friendship Roxas has seen, and one unmarred by the complications of being a nobody or working for a sociopath. Afterwards, the trio talks about what they did on their day off, which includes some top-tier banter. Roxas has an amazing quote regarding kids having a month off or summer vacation. How do they hang on to their sanity? I feel like I should be using this screen cap in my day-to-day more often. Axel reveals he'll be going off on a top-secret mission, and the scene shifts to him and Saix talking in Nothing's Call. As you know by now, I love these conversations. Saix scolds Axel for getting too close to the newest members and remarks that he's changed. He's forgotten Frisbee, and he's forgotten his best friend. This is even reflected in Axel's secret report for the day, where he remarks that he's reminded of being a kid who still had a heart when he hangs out with Roxas and Shion, but he just doesn't feel the need to share any of it with Saix.
How about a sea salt ice cream, then?
At number 12 is day 297, Contact. The day starts with a briefing from Saix about how the imposter has been spotted again in Castle Oblivion. Initially, my question was, how? Were they sending someone there for patrol every day? Do they have cameras? How does that work? Well, apparently, according to Saix's secret report from day 51, the Dusks are capable of surveilling and bringing information back to the organization. I guess they do sort of talk in those Cage 2 and 3 scenes, if only through text. Anyway, Roxas and Axel are able to convince Saix to let them go to CO together, but upon arriving, Roxas passes out. He spends most of his time in twilight or a dimly lit castle, so the bright white walls were too much for him. Before he comes to, we get an audio flashback of Riku saying that line that he always says, and Roxas involuntarily says Riku's name. Roxas wants to go back, but Axel knows that's a bad idea.
You should take a breather. I'm fine. We need to get back to CO. CO stands for chill out, bitch!
Riku and Shion appear around the corner, and a zany Scooby-Doo chase ensues. If only Xemnas put up more nothing spaghetti to block them in. The mission ends up amounting to chasing Riku through the tunnels and smacking him a few times. You'll probably want to use the bottom screen again to track him since he can teleport away. Riku's just running interference right now, so he won't bother to attack back, and most of your attacks will bounce right off of him, so it can be a bit hard to determine if you're actually doing anything to progress the mission along. But eventually, you corner him and he fucks off. Roxas and Axel contemplate what would happen if Shion were to come back home. Roxas fears she could be turned into a Dusk, which is a fate worse than death if you ask me. As evidenced by the music that plays during the day's mission, this is a tension-building day, and another nice change of pace from the usual batch of the 5 or 6 different mission types.
We'll all have ice cream together.
At number 11 is day 300, Shutdown. This might seem like a weird one to have this high, but I found the gameplay stuff here to be oddly refreshing. Roxas's mission is to take out the Phantom Tail in Neverland. Upon arriving, he sees that Hook and Smee have captured Tink, and he finally decides to stop being a colossal dick and go rescue her, saying the mission can come after. I am choosing to count this as character development. We then have access to the pirate ship from KH1, where Roxas finds Tink and lets her out. He then finds a piece of a treasure map and has to gather more in hopes of finding a chest containing the Heartless he's after. He asks Tink to help him fly again, which he couldn't do at the start of the mission for some reason, I guess if she's captured, the magic stops working. But then she's free during the Ruler of the Sky mission and has to reapply it again? I don't know. The mission sort of takes a detour and becomes a recon mission where you have to examine the cabin and ship deck to find either more pieces of the map or uncover purebloods. Then at the rock faces, you can go to the red X's and literally dig up treasure, which is neat. You don't even get to dig up treasure in KH3. You just find gold mounds and pick up 10 pieces at a time. Eventually, you find an empty chest, and Roxas realizes that the chests aren't connected to the Heartless, Hook's greed slash darkness is. Then the Phantom Tail shows up, and its whole gimmick is that you can't hit it from the front or it'll teleport, but it's not a huge deal since it's so big and there's so much of it to hit, and it doesn't move that quickly. Sometimes it did feel like I didn't hit its head, and it would warp away anyway, though. After it's dead, we see Pete show up and conjure up a plan to summon a big ol' Heartless. I'm sure that'll be fun. I was really struck by the post-mission clock tower scene where RxA meet up but share no words, and it's just kind of sad. They recently went through a particularly rough patch that I have yet to cover, but it's pretty upsetting just seeing them sit there in silence trying to pretend that everything is fine. We then see Naminé and Diz in the pod room, and Naminé says Sora's memory has stopped and he won't wake up if nothing is done. Diz says it's time for the gloves to come off. He does a racism and says nobody shouldn't have ever existed in the first place. Classic Diz. All things considered, the gameplay was spiced up a bit, there was a short, simple, but powerful scene, and we got some pieces being moved along by the external forces, so it's a win in my book.
And some of the wise loved ice cream!
Kicking off the top 10 is day 352, Sunset. A fitting name as we close in on some of the best days in days before I can hopefully finally get some sleep. Please. The day begins with Shion doing her best Wreck-It Ralph impression, and we flash back to a frankly heartbreaking scene where Riku lays out the reality of Shion's situation, and Sora's filling in the details of what needs to happen in order to bring his friend back. It's a bit of an unstoppable force and immovable object situation, Riku's friendship with Sora versus Shion's with Roxas and Axel, but something's gotta give, and Riku's gotta pull off some mental gymnastics to convince Shion that she needs to assimilate. But he at least gives her some time to think about it, not that he'll really take no for an answer at this point. In the gray area, Saix is weirdly nice to Roxas, like he never uses such gentle language or asks him how he's feeling. Which, you slipped up there, Saix, you said the feeling word, that's a demerit. But usually he's like, Roxas, go do this thing, and also fuck you. But today he's all, do you think maybe you could possibly go take out this heartless Uwu? I was just hoping you would, if you don't mind. Have you been working out, by the way? Roxas is clearly taken aback by this, and so was I, until I remembered that this was the trap mission that Saix sets up to make Roxas and Shion fight each other. This motherfucker, he butters you up and then he sends you off to die. He's really smart for someone who doesn't know the word motivation. The mission sends Roxas to Halloween Town to supposedly hunt down an Orcus. Upon reaching it in the graveyard and fighting it for a while, Axel shows up to break up the battle, revealing that Roxas and Shion were sent on the same mission to eliminate the Orcus, and that they both viewed each other as said Orcus. Yeah, wrap your head around that shit. I'm assuming Saix took a literal page out of Zexion's book to pull that one off. Ignoring the technical aspect of this, this rigged mission highlights Saix's, and by extension Xemnas's, treachery and disregard for Shion and Roxas's personhood. Kinda nuts that this gets given the on-screen text treatment in the movie. The three retreat to the clock tower for the day and share their final peaceful moment with each other, which covers an appreciation for their past together, the present sunset, and this heartbreaking and desperate attempt to hang on to a future with each other. Roxas briefly considers the three of them running away together before realizing there's nowhere for them to realistically go and they'd be hunted down by the rest of the members regardless. Afterwards, we see a scene of Diz, Naminé, and Riku in the pod room. Things have come to a standstill with Sora, and Diz says to Riku, "You know what to do." Riku prepares to head off from Memory Skyscraper to fight Roxas to a Linkin Park song in 240p.
It's just the ice cream machine!
Taking things back to happier times, at number 9 is day 96, Shion's Keyblade. This is probably the one you've all been waiting for, and I don't just have it this high for the meme of it all. At this point, we're in the midst of Shion being unable to use her Keyblade, and in the morning, Saix tries to send Roxas and Shion on separate missions, which would expose her inability. Big bro Axel shows up and manages to convince Saix to let RNX team up, and Saix is like, "Fine, but that's it." As they're leaving, Saix says to Axel that he didn't buy his excuse, which adds a bit of depth to this whole interaction. Saix is so outwardly uncaring and even abusive to Roxas, and especially Shion, but his attachment to his past friendship with Axel still has some degree of influence here. You have to read between the lines with a lot of Saix stuff, but doing so in conjunction with reading his secret reports reveal him as one of the more complex characters in the game. The mission sends Roxas and Shion to Beast Castle to take out the bully dog. Upon arriving, they decide to test out having Shion use Roxas's Keyblade in hopes that it'll jog her memory of how to use her own. Roxas is a master of improv and decides he will complete this mission with, that's right, a stick. Aside from this moment being funny and tragically cut from the movie, this also paves the way for a fairly unique and clever mission. It harkens back to being stuck with the wooden sword in Cage 1 Hollow Bastion. It changes things up and shifts your priorities, but doesn't overstay its welcome or become frustrating, at least for me. Your physical strikes aren't gonna be worth shit with a stick, but you'll find that magic still works fine, so naturally you'll resort to using that. And the game is smart and kind enough to place a bunch of ethers in the mission as to avoid a situation similar to the Leech Grave problem. In fact, every single chest contains an ether, so even if you come in with one offensive spell, you'll be able to use it another 6 times if you take the time to explore. Even still, the stick is actually way more effective than the wooden sword, so you can reasonably take out enemies with only physical hits. Even stiller, you don't actually need to fight anything besides the bully dog, so you can either run interference while Shion kills things or just save up your magic for the fight in the ballroom. Once you deal with the mutt, Shion is able to summon her Keyblade back and jumps up and down with Roxas adorably, which is also sadly not preserved for the movie. Back at the clock tower, the three celebrate Shion's reclamation of the Keyblade in what's probably the most copacetic moment in the game. There's no real secrets being kept besides Axel having met Sora. No imposters, nobody's in a coma, everyone has control over their weapons, nobody knows Shion used to be a blank JCPenney's mannequin, everything is just nice and serene. Gotta appreciate moments like this while you still can.
Let's meet up for ice cream again.
Continuing the thread of strong trio moments, at number 8 is day 193, Memories. This day is notable for being the only mission where all three members of the trio get to team up for the day. On one hand, it would have been fun to see this, or really any three-person missions, more often, but this one does feel more special and memorable for being the only one of its kind. The day starts off with Shion experiencing the memory of Sora sacrificing himself in KH1, which jolts her out of her coma. Roxas tells her she's been asleep for 20 days and that he was starting to get worried. 20 days seems like a long time to wait before you begin the process of getting worried, but whatever. Shion notices that Roxas has been bringing her seashells, hopefully not noticing that he's been recycling all the ones she gave him at the beginning of the game. Like a handful of the other days that I enjoy, we also get an Axel and Saix moment. The mission is preceded by Axel convincing Saix to remove the stick from the last mission that he has up his ass and let Shion accompany Roxas and Axel on their mission. The trio goes to Twilight Town with two big heartless targets, a heat saber in the sandlot and a destroyer at the station plaza.
Destroy her? Good idea, that's what I've been saying.
No, Saix. Along the way, you'll come across several detonators, and if you play the game well, like I do, you'll blow everyone the fuck up by having Roxas cast fire on it while he's right on top of everyone. At the sandlot, we completely clowned on the heat saber. It didn't matter that we were all on fire, we fucked him right up. Upon reaching the station plaza, Shion, who's had a KH1 cutscene playlist running in her head, reaches the Kairi Promise scene and collapses. Collapsing, disappearing, and ice cream, those are her big three. Axel tends to Shion while Roxas fights the destroyer on his own. Afterwards, they bring Shion back to the castle, and as fun as it was to have a three-man mission, the best part of the day may be when Axel finally rebukes Saix and tells him to shut his mouth after he makes a shitty comment. If Saix let himself believe he had feelings, they'd definitely be hurt in this moment. The boys take Shion to her room, and Axel confirms that the three of them are indeed best friends. They are now rank 10 confidants with each other, I am thou art I, etc. Shion reveals that she's been faking the whole thing just to hear Axel say something nice about her. I can't say that I blame her if that were true at all.
Sea salt ice cream.
Let's forget about that sweet moment and get back to the drama. For the indisposable number 7, we have day 298, Fracture. The name of the day refers to the fracture that Axel creates in Shion's neck bones. That's right, baby, it's Karate Chop Day! The day starts with Saix telling Axel that Shion has betrayed the organization. As a reminder, this day happens immediately after the day Roxas and Axel chased Riku in the tunnels. Saix authorizes Axel to bring Shion back by whatever means necessary, even if it means killing her, while Roxas is sent to look for the imposter again. I wonder if this group will ever address how Saix openly advocated and planned for the murder of Roxas and Shion, but I have a feeling we'll never see it. Roxas heads off to Twilight Town, and after getting relentlessly belly-flopped by Mega Shadows, he sees a hooded figure in the tram common. It's obviously Shion, but Roxas didn't pay attention to the models from the last mission. So ensues a similar chase sequence to the one with Riku, with Shion being far more mobile than she ever is in any of your missions with her.
When the fuck did she learn how to teleport?
Once again, make use of that minimap, this game is on the DS for a reason. Eventually, you corner her, which activates a real cutscene. Roxas pleads for Shion to come back home, but she raises her keyblade at him. And like, how dare you? I hit dogs with a stick for an entire afternoon to get you that key back. Before anything can happen, Axel intervenes, and the game saves a lot of money and space by having the ensuing fight take place just barely out of view. It's actually really well done. As brief as it is, it's cool how they frame it with Roxas in the background looking towards us while the other two fight in the foreground.
Stop!
Roxas, way to go! I didn't know you learned stop! Great teamwork, buddy!
With that, Axel takes Shion back home, where he's confronted by Roxas, who thought it was implied that karate chopping each other was entirely outside the friend code. Axel retorts that none of this is about friendship, and he's right. Not a single ice cream was eaten on this day.
Man, this is some good ice cream, huh?
At number 6 is day 353, Resolve. Like many good days, it starts with Axel and Saix bitching at each other. Saix lays it out in simple terms for Axel. At this point, they have no need for both Roxas and Shion in the organization. And Axel has known that there's no endgame for the three of them for a while now, but now it's being made super clear to him. He remarks in his secret report today that he can't bring himself to get rid of either of them, and he knows that there's no real future together for the three of them. But as we'll see, this mindset is going to run contrary with his actions. He'll be trying to keep them all together no matter how impractical it may be and at any cost, even if he has to be the bad guy to do so. Before the mission starts, we get another wild combination of Axel, Shion, and Zigbar, and Axel even comments on how unlikely of a trio they are.
It's not every day that we get to go for a stroll with number 2 himself.
That's right, they call me number 2 cause I'm the shit.
I also don't want to ignore the fact that the trio knows fully well that Saix set up Roxas and Shion to fight the day prior, so I don't know how they're not just holding him down and taking his lunch money, or really doing anything he says. Once everyone departs for their missions, we cut to a scene in the Tea Party Garden, and this is like the scene that comes to mind when I think of days. Which is maybe weird considering it's the scene that briefly features a Birth by Sleep character, but Zigbar's vision of Shion as Venhir was one of the coolest and most surprising moments in the game. Just to clarify, Ven hadn't even been properly introduced as a character outside of the Cage 2 secret ending or promotional materials and interviews, and Days came out a year before BBS. So this is one of the most fun pieces of foreshadowing in the game, and I still remember people online being really excited by it back in 2009. Shion runs off yet again, Zigbar is unconscious, and Axel is left without a ride home. Meanwhile, Roxas's mission for the day has him hunting down six giant Heartless in something of a boss rush. A stalwart blade, a poison plant, a Gigas shadow, a powered armor, an Orcus, and a Veil Lizard. Fuck the powered armor, everything else was fine. The Dust Flyer shows up as an optional boss at the station plaza if you want to fill up the bonus gauge, and I did not. Back at the castle, it's an administrative nightmare. Axel and Zigbar share the blame for Shion getting away, and Saix is pissed off because now they're stuck with the weaker Keyblade wielder. We know that Axel knows the truth about everything regarding Shion and Roxas, and he's stuck between a rock and a hard place because he knows telling Roxas directly what's going on will just hasten the end of everything. Nevertheless, he still tries and fails miserably to explain to Roxas what's going on.
Roxas, Shion is like a mirror that reflects you.
What the fuck is this, a Jaden Smith tweet?
Roxas runs off, annoyed, and I can't blame him. We then see Shion and Riku meet at Beast Castle, and Shion is ready to finally take Riku's advice and ditch the organization.
Sea salt ice cream.
Closing in on our top 5 here, in the number 5 spot is day 299, Sora. This might be another one that could be considered really high up since it's a Shadow Glob mission in Neverland, but I have my reasons. You already know, it starts off with an Axel and Saix scene, and a fully voiced one at that. The big wham line here is Saix dropping Lee on Axel for the first time in the series. There weren't exactly a ton of options for the rearranged Axel somebody name, but it was really cool to see it confirmed back in the day. All of the Ella and Lay truthers were fuming though. Saix asks Lee if he'd rather suffer the loss of a made-up friendship or a real one, but I'm pretty sure he made his choice quite a long time ago at this point. Roxas then manages to book an audience with Xemnas to ask him about Shion, which is crazy that he was able to catch him in the middle of his busy schedule of sitting while doing nothing and standing while doing nothing. This is where we get the moment of Roxas finally realizing that Sora is a thing.
Who is Sora?
I want you to write down your name and look at it for a long time.
Obviously, we hold the knowledge of what Roxas's connection is to Sora, but Roxas just sort of sits on this information. He has something to do with this guy, and Shion is involved somehow, but he doesn't really reference it again for another 2 months in dialogue or even his diary. As I mentioned, the mission sends Roxas to Neverland to destroy Shadow Globs, and to its credit, this is the best mission of that type. The globs are actually sort of hidden instead of just in plain sight waiting for you to bludgeon them. The world is also set at night this time, which is a cool change of pace, plus you get access to the ship deck and Captain's Cabin for the first time. Afterwards, Xemnas and Saix meet in the Round Room, where Xemnas explains how Sora's influence has caused Shion to turn from it into she. Saix is like,
absolutely not, I've been calling her it in my diary for like a whole year now.
We then see blindfolded Riku standing at Memory Skyscraper, and Shion sitting in her room, plotting her next bout of collapsing and or disappearing. All in all, this was a short but sweet day with a lot of moving pieces, and a gameplay segment that didn't overstay its welcome.
Royal Berry Ice Cream!
And at number 4 is our final cutscene-only day, day 356, Place to Belong. You know the one, it's the big scene, potentially the most well-acted and dramatic moment in the game. And yeah, that one scene did rocket this day all the way up to number 4 because it's a great scene. I've always considered Memorized from BBS to be the core Lee scene, but if we're talking about his time as Axel, it's gotta be this one. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. The day starts in the White Room with Naminé and Shion, who's finally decided to meet her at Riku's suggestion. Shion, fully aware of what getting Sora to wake back up will entail, is ready to go along with the process, just asking Naminé to look out for Roxas in return. Just as she's ready to go, the racist shows up and alerts them that Axel is at their gate. Shion runs out, and then the real scene begins. My 6th grade self was popping the fuck off at this scene. All of the tension is finally released here. Axel is beyond frustrated by the circumstances, and he tries to keep it all contained, but gradually gets more desperate as the two talk. He's known the truth about Shion for quite a while, and he's also known that her existence inherently complicates his life and friendships, both old and new. But at the same time, cutting through the bullshit of her apparently being a replica who was never supposed to be anything like a real person, the bullshit of her being used as a tool for the organization, beyond all of that icky stuff, she's still his friend, and he's committed to keeping their trio together by whatever means necessary. Shion's calm and solemn demeanor and resignation to her fate just gets Axel more and more frustrated until he breaks and just starts yelling. All the while, the other promise is wailing away in the background. After one of the most emotionally charged scenes in the game, this clash between two best friends, we follow it up with this antithesis. Axel brings Shion back to the castle and collapses from exhaustion, and Xemnas strolls in, picks up his wayward tool of destruction, and leaves, cold, procedural, and matter-of-fact.
Your ice cream's melting.
Going back in time just one day before all that drama, at number 3 is day 355, Unsaid, Unheard. You may have noticed that Roxas didn't appear at all on that last day, and that's because he was catching his breath after his fucking awesome prison break. Of course all the days where you're either quitting your shitty job or no longer doing it would be at the top. Roxas wakes up, and after having sat on the whole Sora thing from Xemnas for like 50-something days, he decides it's time to try and figure that out. I guess he can't blame him for not inquiring sooner, he's been busy with doing missions and not telling Axel about the Winter Stick. Speaking of Axel, Roxas decides to go confront him, and we essentially get the point of no return message. Roxas asks how long Axel has known the truth about Shion, and he's like, oh, I don't know, a while? And then Roxas pulls off possibly the greatest catchphrase reversal of all time on Axel. Didn't get it memorized, huh? Roxas pelts Axel with question after question, and Axel is convinced that the lie Roxas is living would be more comfortable than the truth, but he's reading this all wrong. Roxas has been dicked around by the power players in the organization, his own friends, and the fucking leech grave he's headed up to here with all this bullshit. Between this conversation with Axel and his moment of reflection in Agrabah from the night before, Roxas realizes there's nothing left for him here. Roxas goes to collect his things, realizes he has no things besides a popsicle stick, and even that mocks him, so it's too painful to bring along. And then boom, we've got free roam of the castle. We've been cooped up in the gray area for 354 days, only ever allowed to leave to break some pottery in the Hall of Empty Melodies, but now it's time to blow this joint. Mirroring Sora's ascent through the castle in KH2, Roxas descends to its lowest level, optionally slicing through his underlings as he progresses. I guess they can either tell that he's escaping, or the castle just has a strict curfew. At the bottom of the castle, Saix awaits, with a badass line that you know he's been holding onto for weeks. And suddenly, catharsis is the name of the game. Finally, finally a chance to kick your manager in the shins, it's all I've ever wanted. Saix is definitely more bark than bite, I'd say he polished up on his skills a bit by the time Sora fights him in 2, but I'm kinda glad he goes down easy just to show how Roxas has always been stronger and his strength has ultimately been more useful to the organization than any of Saix's schedules or punch cards ever could be. Roxas leaves Saix on the floor, not even sparing him a word as he bemoans that he lacks the strength of Kingdom Hearts. I'd get used to that if I were you. And the bow on top, the perfect coda that ties it back to Cage 2, we get the Nobody Would Miss Me scene where Axel makes his final attempt to change Roxas's mind and fate.
I'm gonna miss this ice cream thing we do.
So, the last 2 days left on the list are also the last 2 playable days in the game, and they're both heavy hitters for obvious reasons. One is definitely more substantial in the gameplay and character sense, whereas the other is maybe more concerned with wish fulfillment. Honestly, on any given day, I could see myself swapping the two, but on this day, on my personal day, 9608, I'm ranking Roxas's day 357 tiers in the number 2 spot. I understand if you're annoyed with me for not having it first, since it is pretty remarkable in every way. The day starts with Roxas freshly unemployed in Twilight Town. He enters the sandlot, and as if to add insult to injury, he sees HPO running around. 3 normal friends whose biggest problem is dropping their ice creams or doing summer projects. Old habits die hard, and Roxas is as directionless as ever, so he goes to the only place he's ever really found any comfort, the clock tower at Station Plaza. But Roxas does have one true friend still in his life, because the Moogle left with him, what a guy. Either he likes Roxas the best, or he just gets more business from him than the remaining 7 members combined. The game makes it clear that this is really it now, before Roxas heads up to the clock tower. You know what I always forget, even though it's right there? I totally forget that Shion still has one last ice cream with Roxas before shit hits the fan here. It's almost like a consolation prize, the calm before the storm, just one more for the road. And it's so tragic because even in these final moments between the two, even though Roxas is finally being given a grain of information, he still doesn't even have the true, clearest picture of what's going on. It's not 100% clear what happened with Shion when Xemnas walked away with her the day prior, so she's either been compelled by Xemnas to attack Roxas or she's putting on a show, essentially manipulating him into striking her down, or a little bit of both. Xemnas wants Shion to absorb Roxas so his plans can continue, but Shion doesn't want that. Riku gave her the time to search her feelings regarding returning to Sora, and she settled on the fact that both her and Roxas should return to him so they can all be whole. But she knows Roxas hasn't been afforded the same luxury of information or the same amount of time to think it all over. She's confident that he will understand under the right conditions, but those conditions can't realistically be met with her still in the picture. And at this point, like she says, she's running out of time. So she either intentionally goads Roxas into fighting by acting threatening towards him, or whatever Xemnas did to her is making her attack, or some combination, or maybe there is an inner struggle here, it's hard to say. Given that the worlds are littered with these devices that are designed to power Shion up, plus the fact that she's been draining Roxas of his power, it's hard to picture a scenario where Roxas defeats Shion unless he truly believes he's fighting for his life here. And so that fight begins, taking us to a handful of previous worlds where said devices have been left. I doubt it's a hot take, but I do think it's the best boss fight in the game, both on a technical level and just for the marvel of it all. The devices all allow Shion to draw on strength from not just Sora and his memories, but seemingly the worlds themselves. In the Wonderland portion, we can immediately see this fusion of Shion's own strength and that which she draws from Sora, imitating his basic early game combo and Sonic Blade, while also using some sort of powerful healing shield. And then in Halloween Town, she morphs into this design that looks like it's inspired by the Experiment or the 1FM Chimera enemy, and now she's throwing in Sora's Ragnarok move, his vortex attack, and also this impressive gymnastics-looking thing. Phase 3 takes us to Agrabah's Lamp Chamber, where Rox has placed one of the devices intended to aid in his own demise. Shion takes on a Kurt Zisa-inspired look, and now Ars Arcanum is her signature move. I should note, each time you get through a phase, the music track actually changes, so you're treated with a whopping 4 songs throughout this encounter, shifting from Shrouding Dark Cloud to Vim and Vigor to Fight and Away, and finally Vector to the Heavens. And this final part is where the fight truly begins. Shion, I guess drawing power from the clock tower, becomes just about as big as it, but is kind enough to make Roxas an invisible sky floor to fight on. Meanwhile, Pence looks up to the sky like, Jesus, I've been eating way too much fucking ice cream. I do think this fight is the perfect amount of challenge. There's like 6 different attacks Shion can use, and you need to learn the timing and right way to handle each one, but it's not unforgiving. My one gripe is that the lightning or lasers or whatever that shoot down from above don't really feel like something that's inherently blockable, but once you learn that that's the move instead of trying to dodge them, it becomes a lot more manageable. It's crazy to think that Shion is potentially holding back here, considering it really looks like she's pulling out all the stops. I mean, I felt pretty convinced she meant business given how many times I died to her on stream. But after a long and flashy fight, Shion finally shrinks back down to a reasonable size, and it's time for her to go. And yeah, the Zoliphant in the room here is the who else will I have ice cream with line, and here's the thing. I'm of two minds about this. I fully understand that Roxas's understanding of friendship is built upon the core foundational material of eating ice cream with one another. To his knowledge, that is what friends do. I'm not oblivious to the 30 hours of context that precedes this moment that ice cream is a fundamental aspect of the positive relationships Roxas has had in his very limited time as a person. I truly, honestly get all of that. And I still just don't like it. I wanna like it. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's how the line is delivered, or maybe there's something in the back of my head, an evil Jiminy Cricket that's still failing to fully appreciate it. Like, my brain says it's fine, but my heart says otherwise. I don't know, I guess maybe it's because it's the very last thing he says to her, or that it seems a bit more concerned with himself than her. It's an I statement, you know, not a you statement. Even if we rearranged it a bit or added some runway, like, no, Shion, you can't go. You, me, and Axel will have ice cream together again. I don't know. Apparently, and I just looked this up, that's kind of close to what the Japanese line was, but I get it, you gotta match the lip flaps, it happens. Nevertheless, Shion's story comes to a close for now, and effectively wouldn't resume for another 10 years. Back at the castle, Axel finds Roxas's left-behind luggage, a popsicle stick that says winner, the recipient of which is a traumatized child who just killed one of his own best friends. What a fucking gut punch.
No more ice cream for you.
So let's just shake it off and do some cool shit, baby. It's day 358, believe, and I do believe that this is the best day's day, or at least today I do. As I said before, this is wish fulfillment to the max. This is, for many, a 7-year promise being upheld. And I'll fully admit that this is my ape brain winning out my KH1 fanboyism, but can you truly blame me? Don't answer that. You know what I find truly amazing about playing that KH1 secret ending? The whole thing could have so easily not happened if it was just treated as a concept trailer like Nomura had initially intended. It was just supposed to kind of vaguely show off some ideas and cool Keyblade dudes killing stuff. But then when KH2 was wrapping up, Nojima had to go back into the script and try to insert as many of these lines as he could so it would make sense. And when you get down to it, that's kind of what Days is itself. It's this big, long justification to fill in all the rest of the gaps that led up to another side, another story. Sure, you could have seen the bits and pieces of the scene from KH2 and filled in the blanks yourself, but now we arrive at this scene armed with the knowledge of why exactly Roxas has left the organization. He's on a revenge quest to fulfill the final promise he made to a dying friend. I just think it's such a powerful and beautiful thing to return to this scene that was truly gripping and mysterious now having experienced this rich narrative that helps explain it all. And yeah, I do think it's a fairly rich narrative, I'll stand by that. And you aren't just watching it either, you get to participate. I know I've given Days a bit more credit than some might when talking about its gameplay, but going from day 357 Roxas to day 358 Roxas is like upgrading from a big wheel to a motorcycle. Roxas puts the hood up and pulls out Oathkeeper in Oblivion, please don't ask me how or why, I cannot fully explain it, and he is just melting these Neo Shadows, just like in the secret ending. This is honestly all just a victory lap, albeit a Pyrrhic one, but also a deserved one after being put through the emotional and physical strain of the Shion fight. Listen, my thumbs hurt when it was done. After tearing through the Dark City, Roxas comes face to face with Riku. Like Saix, maybe even more so, Riku is something of an exhibition battle. He's not really the final boss, that honor goes to Shion. But once again, I'm alright with it here, not only because we just went through a grueling 4-phase gauntlet, but because it makes sense for Roxas to make relatively quick work of Riku. That's how the fight is supposed to go, as dictated by KH2 4 years earlier. It's only when Riku turns on his action replay cheats and uses the Ansem Drive form that he can actually take Roxas down. And when he does, we're greeted with the scene of Roxas' capture as it plays out in Cage 2, only this time appended by bottom screen moments of Xion that are slowly but surely fading away. And Days firmly establishes itself as a tragedy. So ends the short life of a character who was told he was nothing, found friendship and meaning in spite of that, and then had it all stripped away, never fully understanding why. As Xemnas sits in his throne and essentially writes in his report,
"Oh well, this is a setback, but I think I can still get what I want."
All that angst and sadness that culminated in this desperate and dramatic struggle amounts to a minor inconvenience for the powers that be. Sure, 10 years later we'd be able to take solace in the fact that these wrongs would be righted, but even still, it doesn't take away from the manipulation and trauma that Roxas endured for the crime of existence. After all this, Xion, bless her heart, tries her best to offer some words of comfort as Diz is shoving Roxas into a computer. Her words float by as white text on a black background, and that's really what Kingdom Hearts is all about, isn't it? It's always been about the light within the darkness, finding that source of hope, that sometimes naive or even illogical comfort in the face of impossible odds and adversity, or in the worst cases, the end of everything. Even in one of the series' darkest, most depressing, and plainly unfair moments, we're offered at least some kind of an olive branch, something that might rhyme with a promise that everything will be okay. Sometimes that's all you have, and sometimes that's enough. Did I mention how fucking cool it was to dual-wield Oathkeeper? Well, there you have it. I hope you enjoyed. That was, as you could probably tell, the longest video I've ever made. I did not anticipate that I would ever break that record that I set in 2019 for myself with the Cage 1 Level 1 guide. And this quickly snowballed into something much, much bigger than that. As I said up top, this video was basically a promise that I made to my patrons, except it actually wasn't. It was, I said I would do a Days video. I never said I'd rank all of the Days or talk about it to this extent, but it ended up turning into that, and I had fun, and I hope you had fun too. And if you would like to support me or the channel, liking or subscribing would be huge, but also pledging on Patreon is a great way to help me continue to do this and have fun doing it. Because despite the mental, emotional, and even physical discomfort this project put me through at times, I think from being at my desk all day and every day, I did have fun doing this. And I'm just very thankful for all of you who allow me to make this something that I do for a living. If you made it this far, you're a legend. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.